University of Michigan football. Brought to you by Stroh's Signature, the beer with something extra. And by Burger King. Aren't you hungry for a delicious flame-broiled juicy whopper at Burger King now? And by America's largest carpet retailer, New York Carpet World, the better carpet people. And by Highland Appliance, everything you never expected from an appliance store. And Republic Airlines, nobody serves our republic like Republic.
Drab afternoon in Ann Arbor. Drab weather-wise, that is, but temperature-wise, it's perfect for football. Certainly the Michigan fans, better than 100,000, hoping it will not be a drab day for the Wolverines on the playing surface. Hello, everybody. I'm Ray Lane, along with Jim Brandstetter, and opponent number two in the Big Ten chase, the Hoosiers of Indiana. They have trouble with an offense.
Yeah, they do. They really don't have much of an offense. Northwestern beat them last week, but they have one weapon. Name Dwayne Gunn. He probably is the best athlete at a skilled position in the conference. The only problem with Dwayne Gunn, we watched him in pregame, he's had some injury problems, and it looks like maybe he's got a little trouble with his left knee. How effective he'll be this afternoon, we won't know until game time. But if Dwayne Gunn is out there and playing well, Indiana does have a game breaker on offense, and he's the guy they've got to get the ball to in order to stay close to Michigan, because he can make the big play, and it's one thing Michigan must not afford. Give Indiana the big play to Dwayne Gunn.
Meanwhile, the offense for Michigan, oh, what a fine running game.
Kerry Smith, Rick Rogers, Brian Mercer, Eddie Garrett, Steve Smith, you name them. They've got all great running backs, and on a day that is overcast and there is some rain threatening, I expect we'll see Michigan keep it on the ground, much like they did last week against Wisconsin, and really try to beat Indiana up front. And historically, Indiana hasn't been good in the defensive line, and that may be the game plan this afternoon. We'll see a charging chorus of Wolverine backs again.
Well, we'll look for it. We'll have that opening kickoff in just a moment.
Burger King.
They get this ball game underway. The Wolverines of the University of Michigan will be kicking off, and those duties, of course, belong to Todd Slopey, number 99, the senior from Orchard Park, New York, as he gets all set to tee it up in front of the referee, Glenn Fortin. We'll check out that official crew a little bit later on. So Slopey to start it off, and the deep man for Indiana, number 30 is Bobby Howard, number 29, Alex Green, and with these new Indiana uniforms, that cream-colored traveling uniform and the red numbers, a little tough to pick up. But our opening kickoff is underway, and a spiral going down to the goal line, picked off by Howard. He gets up to the 15-yard line, tries to crack it up the middle, and is tripped up close to the 18-yard line. On his first return of the 1983 season, as far as kickoff's concerned. Scarcelli gets credit for that tackle for Michigan. Jim out of Warren, Michigan, a junior who attended Warren Woods High School. Well, we'll see a lot of movement and possibly a lot of formations from the Hoosiers this afternoon as they slide it off with a slot. And going out now to the wide receiver, the split end, Len Killebrew. And Killebrew comes up with a reception, his 13th of the year, and Johnny Lott over there to make the stop. Indiana's offensive line, and not a great bit of experience on that right side, but big, weighing 270 pounds as an average. The backfield, Steve Bradley, a youngster. Howard and Salters get some pretty good speed. The receivers, probably the strongest part that they have in their offensive unit. Pitch to the right side, and coming in there is Alex Green, freshman out of Illinois, Glen Allen, and Mike Bourne right over there in a hurry to greet him.
Both Bourne and Mallory coming over real quick from their linebacker's position, and we expect Indiana to do a lot of throwing, and it's kind of a surprise here that a quick pitch to try to get Green outside. There you see Bourne coming over along with Mallory. Both inside backers got outside on the corner real quick.
They bring their tight end, McNabb, over to the right side and start him in motion. Second down and nine. And that went out to Alex Green, completed, gets a first down and run out of bounds on the far side of the field, close to the Indiana 44. And again, John Lott leading the way over there. Hewlett also in on the tackle.
One of the keys to Indiana successfully offensively this afternoon, I think, as we see early, is they've got to throw the little short pass and force Michigan back off the ball a little bit, and then they'll try to run some. But I think most of the time, we'll see the ball in the air.
Well, you see a little bit of a change here in the linebackers on defense for Michigan as Carlton Rose gets the start. 25 yards picked up so far by Indiana on a couple of passes. And coming on a crisscross that time, is that Gunn? And was for his first reception, Mike Mallory in there to make the stop. And so Gunn comes up with his 18th catch of the year. He has been the busiest man as far as receiver.
Well, you can see why Gunn is such a good receiver. This ball is not thrown real well. He adjusts to the ball behind him and makes the catch going down. Real good catch by Gunn, and Indiana doing real well offensively here in that first series.
Got 9 yards on that completion. It's second down and one. And a little delay movement that time. Walsh on the carry, the fullback, and cracks down to the Michigan 35-yard line. Well, they have plenty of daylight that time on the left side.
Indiana's doing better against Michigan here in his first drive on the ground than they did all last week against Northwestern. This is a simple draw play. Michigan is coming, and they kick it in, and Walsh breaks it outside, and the block is on Kevin Brooks that allowed Walsh to get outside. So Michigan defensively has got to sharpen up inside because Indiana's been hitting them with a little short pass on first down, then coming back with a good run on second and short.
But I've got first and 10 right now as McNabb goes in motion for Indiana. And almost intercept. Broken up in there by Mike Mallory. Rule incomplete.
The Michigan defender got the ball, and he didn't catch it on the fly. I think the ball hit a leg. It never hit the ground, right? Popped up, and Mike Bourne made the interception, but the referee is ruling the ball's incomplete. The ball probably shouldn't have been thrown in here because he throws right between two linebackers. Now watch the ball bounce. Does it hit the ground? It hits Boren's back, and it lands on his leg. It never did hit the ground, so that is an interception. The referee saw it hit the ground.
Second and 10, and a flag goes down on the 30-yard line. Almost a 10-yard carry going up the middle that time, and on that carry was Jack Walsh, their senior fullback.
Great balance by Walsh. You saw him put his hand down on the ground to keep his balance. He was knocked down and tripped at the line of scrimmage, but got 9 yards just really keeping his balance with his left hand on the ground.
The Hoosiers, in addition to their passing, they've been able to find some daylight in that line so far, a little bit unusual. So the Wolverines are going to have to tighten things up. They'll bring it back, and now they're going to march it off from the line of scrimmage for a 5-yard penalty. From the line of scrimmage. Against Michigan.
Too many men on the field, Ray. It's a 5-yard penalty, so Weiss takes the 5 yards, and now he's looking at a second down and 5. I don't know why he didn't take the run. He would have been second and 1. Is that correct?
Well, 1 or 2, yep. No, they would have gone a third down.
Oh, okay.
They would have gone a third down. All right, second and 5 for the Hoosiers. And Bradley goes over the top, hurried that time, and put it into the turf for an incompleted pass. Cooper covering on that play. And again, Gunn coming over the middle. And Green, that was Green actually, number 29, coming over the middle, the tailback.
I think you're right, though, when you said that he was getting some pressure. Bradley, the quarterback, is a good, big, strong kid. But Michigan has got to put some pressure on him, and I think we saw the results of some pressure there. They didn't get back close enough to sack him, but forced him to throw it early, and he threw a bad ball.
Third and 5, Green and Walsh, the running backs now for Indiana. Benson in motion. The fullback carrying goes nowhere, and coming up there in a hurry to greet him, Vince DeFelice. Boy, he was right around the ankles. Big stop.
DeFelice was last week's defensive champion of the week. And take a look from the left side of your screen. He's playing that left tackle. Here's the draw, and Felice stays right at home, beats the block, and that was Kevin Brooks also in there to help out. But Felice was the guy coming in there real strong, beating the block at the line of scrimmage. Now we got a long field goal try from the Hoosiers.
Okay, this is Doug Smith. He's going to try for a 47-yarder. Ball they marked at the 37-yard line. He has a 47-yard field goal to his credit this year, and that was against Kentucky in the second game of the year. Last week, missed on 47 yards against Northwestern. This time, he is off to the right and no good. So the Hoosiers attempt to get three. It won't go, and Michigan will have the ball at its own 20-yard line. No score with 11:50 to go.
I left a big company to turn my hobby into my living.
Here come the Wolverines for the first play of the line of scrimmage. This afternoon's ball game. Look at Sim Nelson in motion. And on the carry and a lot of daylight. Moving with Rick Rogers. And Rogers carries across the 40-yard line. Very close to the first down.
Take a look at the replay here. Milt Carthens is the tight end in motion, 83. Now he will kick out on the linebacker. Right there is the block, and that allows Rogers to cut it back up inside. Nelson, Sim Nelson, gets a block on two people before Hendrickson can come up and make the stop. Good play on a first down by the Wolverine.
On Caddis's, or rather on Carthens, good block. We saw Jeff McBain really cut down. It was first and 10 on that carry by the Wolverines. And up to around the 42, maybe the 43-yard line. Picked up a couple of yards. And flagged down. Michigan's offensive line staying the same. Eddie Garrett got the start at fullback this afternoon. And the receiver, same that we've seen the past 3 weeks. Second down and 8. Garrett and Rogers, the running backs for the Wolverines. And Steve Smith for the first time going to the air. And he is long, intended that time for his wide receiver, Giovanni Johnson. And overshot him by about 5 yards. Might have been a little mixed up in the pattern, too.
Yeah, well, it also looked like Jeff McBain, their cornerback out there, was holding on to Giovanni. I don't know. Giovanni seemed to stop his pattern right in the middle, and it looked to me as though McBain had a pretty good hold on him. I'm surprised that we didn't get a call on that one.
At left guard, the strong side, DiOrio back in there now. Belores comes out for Michigan. We've got third down and 8. They slot now the wing position. Rogers on the left side. And the draw coming up the middle. Smith has the first down to the 40, to the 35-yard line of Indiana. Just doing a little toe dancing through the line of scrimmage, found the big hole, and got all the way down to the 35 of Indiana. 23-yard gain, finally brought down by Cristofoli.
Straight quarterback draw. Good block by DiOrio, clearing out Smith, their good defensive tackle. And there is Eddie Garrett, the fullback, gets a real good block again on that safety, number 43, Hendrickson. And Steve Smith just had a lot of room. The reason that play went, because it was well blocked.
They move Bean, the wide receiver, on the left side. Johnson to the right side. And the fake to Garrett, the pitch out of the option, going to Rogers around the right side. First down, gets back in, 15, 10, 5, touchdown Michigan. Rick Rogers rolling for 35 yards and has his fifth touchdown of the season on the ground. Got some good blocking from Bean and Nelson.
Yes, he did. And watch the block here by Nelson. Right there, he's on the left side of your screen. Follows him, and he finally gets Sigler down on the ground. And then that's a great cut by Rogers, and another great cut behind the pursuit into the end zone. That is the key to the option, is that tight end blocking on the cornerback, because no runner worth assault really should be tackled open field one-on-one.
Bob Bergeron to try for the extra point as Michigan moves 70 yards in 5 plays and taking only a minute and 52 seconds to do it. All set to go now as the officials had decided to take a little extra time and doing so again right now. Now wait a minute, we got a flag down now in the end zone of Indiana. Down a late flag after the touchdown run by Rogers, but prior to the attempt for the extra point.
We haven't yet seen a signal from the official, so we don't really know what it is yet. Too many men on the field for Indiana.
One called against Michigan that way a little bit earlier, and this time against Indiana. So Bergeron to try for the extra point. Perfect Clinic through the uprights, and Michigan now with a 7-0 lead in the opening quarter with 9:58 to go. Michigan all set to kick off, and again, it was a question, I think, coming in this ball game of whether Indiana could stop the rushing of Michigan, the ground game. And in this early moments of the first quarter, the Hoosiers did not. Slopey all set to kick off with Green and Howard back there to handle it. This will be Howard about 3 yards deep in his end zone. And goes nowhere. Gets to the 9-yard line and a gang tackling by the Wolverines.
Should have never tried to get it out of there, Ray, because when you're 3-4 yards deep in the end zone, you don't return it. Let's take a look at the touchdown. Two keys to this play. Smith down the line. Here comes the end. He tries to tackle Smith. He'd get rid of the ball to Rogers. Then number four for Indiana, Sigler, is blocked by Nelson, and Rogers is able to split those two defensive backs, made a great cut back to the middle of the field, got him into the end zone. Good running, but the play was blocked really well at the corner.
Alex Green and Walsh, the running backs behind Bradley for Indiana, gun the wide man on the left side. And going over the middle, and a nice catch that time by Kennebrew to split in. They lined up with three wide receivers on that left side.
You can see that Sam Weiss, the coach at Indiana, is not afraid at all to go to the air in any position. Here Bradley's in the end zone, getting some decent rush, throws it into traffic, and that's just a great catch by Kennebrew. Michigan had fairly decent coverage, but the ball was thrown up there, and Kennebrew laid out to get it.
First down at the 22 of Indiana. Kennebrew, a senior out of Robbins, Illinois. And now the little swing pass out to the tight end, Scott McNabb. McNabb got a couple of extra yards just by putting that head down in there. He had Hewlett beating him, and also Mike Boren around the bottom.
Well, I think we're going to see a lot of that now. Indiana going to the pass. They'll go to it anywhere. We saw them come out of their own end zone with a pass. And the tight end screen is a play Michigan hasn't seen yet this year because they've played against teams that use the backs for their screens. And we take a look at Michigan going 70 yards using only a minute and 52 to score their first touchdown. But the key again, all on the ground mostly and all outside with their big gainers.
Second and three for the Hoosiers. Alex Green carries, goes nowhere. He is greeted right at the line of scrimmage. Kevin Brooks comes up very quickly from that tackle spot on the right side. Also, it was Bourne moving up and had some help in there also from DeFelice and Mallory.
Michigan is second in the conference against the rush. And you can see that there just is no hole there. The linebackers are not being blocked by Indiana's up front people. Indiana's up front offensive line are very, very big, Ray, but they're not real mobile. And against a quick defensive line, which Michigan has, they're going to have their problems.
All right, Terry Smith checks in the place of Benson at a wide receiver. But the pitch right now is going to Alex Green and should have enough for the first down, close to the 34-yard line. Had to get up to around the 32 for that. Cochran drove him out of bounds. By the way, if you think you're going to see an aerial circus from Indiana, there's a good chance you will today. Because last week, Bradley, the quarterback, a sophomore out of Knox, Indiana, went to the air 44 times against the Wildcats of Northwestern and completed 21 of them. First and 10 at the 34 of Indiana. Michigan leads by a score of 7-0. 8:14 to go in the opening quarter. Alex Green goes to that wing position on the right side now. He is the tailback. Walsh is... picks up that time. Actually, he had his split in Kennebrew and he opened, but Kennebrew was not looking for the ball.
Looked like they were running a crossing pattern, and Sam Weiss is the former quarterback coach for the San Francisco 49ers, and a lot of his theory on offensive passing is the pick game, where they're picking defensive linebackers. It's illegal tactic in collegiate football. You cannot do it. But you try, and if you get away with it and the officials aren't watching, that can happen. And that's what they tried to do there. They just missed it.
Nickel defense employed now by Michigan. Five defensive backs in there. And almost completed at the 50-yard line. Kim John Locke. Look as if he was going to pull it down.
Absolutely. Remember against Washington, right? Michigan's defensive backs were giving him so much room. But watch how tight Lott is here on the wideout. He comes up, and as he gets his hands on the ball, there's Lott stripping his arms down, trying to stop him from making that catch. And that was Benson, the wideout, the backup to Dwayne Gunn, who was trying to make that catch. He probably should have made it. Bradley already having a fairly decent day, over 50% passing for 54 yards.
Third and 10 for the Hoosiers. They are 1-for-2 in third down conversions. Firing low, and it was close to Gunn over there at the 44-yard line. The official claims it is a completion and very close to a first down. But Gunn with good quickness. He is not 100% coming in this ball game. Bad left leg on him. Not moving like we can see him, but still makes those tough catches.
Yeah, Gunn has had some ankle and knee troubles. And the problem there was is that you've got to give Dwayne Gunn some respect because he goes deep. He can beat you real seriously. So they'll give him a little bit more room. The ball thrown real well. Gunn adjusted really good, came back to the ball, made a great catch on the ground, and got enough for the first down. That's a receiver, because that ball was not thrown real well. And that's the kind of thing you expect from a big play receiver. Make that catch when it doesn't look like he should. Anthony Carter did it for 4 years here at Michigan, and Gunn's the same kind of player.
That's what the Michigan coaches have been talking about all week. Gunn, the Anthony Carter type, the big play type. Don't let him have a big play against you. He's made 2 receptions, good for 19 yards thus far. First and 10 for the Hoosiers. And this time Bradley keeps. One of the few times you'll see Bradley go up the middle like that. Sometimes he'll roll out on the option, but he gets a first down to the Michigan 45-yard line. Cooper and Hassel making the tackle.
Well, that play was designed to go outside, but look at Mike Bourne. He reacts so quickly outside that Bradley read that, and he cut back inside over the center. Now, Mike Bourne has got to learn to stay home a little bit better because that will happen all day long. He can't just skate out of there.
Hoosiers picked up their 7th first down, and on a carry, the fullback that time, Jack Walsh, might have got about 3 yards out of that carry over left guard. DeFelice in there along with Mike Bourne. So it'll go to 2nd down and about 7 yards for the Hoosiers. If you just joined us, Michigan leading by a score of 7-0 with 7 minutes to go in the opening quarter.
But most impressive, I think, Ray, is the fact that Indiana offensively has moved the ball fairly successfully against the Michigan defense.
Well, we talk about the first-year coach, Sam Weish, of course, of the Hoosiers. Boy, he had them in contact in drills Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday after their pitiful performance against Northwestern. Flag goes down on that carry by the Hoosiers, getting close to the 35-yard line of Michigan. And on the carry was Bobby Howard. Gant in there to make a stop along with Cochran. Holding against Indiana.
You know, one of the things we wondered about coming into this game, Ray, was what Indiana would react like after Sam Weish really blistered them in the media. He said we had some rotten apples on this club. He said that some of them just didn't want to play. And you wonder, a team can do one of two things. They can either lay down and, you know, the season is gone, or they can get emotionally aroused and get ready to play. I think in this instance, at least from the early part of this game, I think that we've seen Indiana react favorably to what Weish was talking about back in the Monday afternoon press conference when he ripped his players.
I'll tell you, there was a lot of eyebrows raised after he made those strong comments about his young players of the Hoosiers. Weish in his first season after 4 years as an assistant coach for the San Francisco 49ers. So they go to 2nd down now and 17 for the Hoosiers. Bradley going to the air and broken up by Cochran. Intended that time for Terry Smith, and Cochran doing a good job flicking that ball away.
Got a hand up there. They were covering with a 2-deep coverage. Cochran had the receiver short, and then he trails him, and coming over was Cooper from his safety position. But good reaction by Cochran. He reacted to the ball, got his hand up to bat it away.
Coming into this ball game, the Wolverines in the Big Ten on pass defense, 4th in the conference. Indiana 5th on defense against that pass. And passing situation right now, 3rd and 17, as Bradley looks for one of his receivers. Going deep, intended for Gunn, enters. intercepted by Mallory, and Mallory goes down at his own 34-yard line. Young Mike Mallory comes up with a second interception of the 83 season.
Against a team like Indiana that you know is going to throw a lot, linebackers are key that they drop back and get deep drops. Here's a deep post by Gunn. Shouldn't have thrown the ball because it was into traffic again. There you see Mallory playing the zone, just stepped over in front of Gunn in that zone coverage. There was no crease there. There was no spot in the zone that was open. Mallory just stepped in front. Easy interception. Michigan makes their own break for the second time in this game.
Well, as you can see, the shot from our stands with all the Michigan fans on hand. A very comfortable day here. Weather-wise, it's been comfortable for Michigan thus far, leading 7-0 with 6:21 to go in the opening quarter. First and 10, and now they put Rogers in the I formation. We might head some
reverse.
Reverse coming around, and this time it's Steve Johnson on a carry. He's still in bounds. Flag goes down, and Johnson gets down to around the 48-yard line of Indiana.
The flag is for a block below the waist, Ray. Steve Smith had to make a block. I'm not sure who it was for Indiana. It might have been Mark Smith, their big tackle. But you've got to block 4 yards on the other side of the line of scrimmage above the waist. And that is the call. It's on Steve Smith. Good play going. And Bo Schembechler is extremely upset because he's, I think, just got another call against him. I'm not sure. But watch. Smith is coming. Right there is the block below the waist. And that is a penalty, and Bo is extremely upset because I think they tacked an extra one on to him.
I think he was discussing it with the side judge down there on the call. And you're absolutely right. They've knocked off some more yardage and put that ball all the way back to the 17, between the 17 and 18-yard line of Michigan. Illegal block. And Bo really hot and heavy out there.
You know, that's the interesting thing about Bo. You know, he's got Indiana, a team that is not expected to do well against him. You want to talk about a guy who's intense about any game he plays? Bo thinks these guys are UCLA or Southern Cal or Nebraska.
First and 26. And on the carry, maybe a yard, 2 yards at the most, a little draw play going up the middle, and Rogers on the carry. Rogers now with that ball at the 18-yard line. Rogers, of course, the fellow with a 35-yard gallop for the first touchdown. Bo also trying to maybe just sort of hype up his team a little bit to try to get him a little more fired up.
Could be.
Second and 26. Boy, Smith with a lot of time goes to Rogers at the 20-yard line, 25, 26-yard line. You can see Smith looking for his deep men, couldn't find anybody, decided to go to his tailback coming out of the backfield.
Well, Indiana defensively playing kind of a prevent in a situation where you're first and 26. They'll give up that underneath pattern, but they won't give that 15 to 18-yard pass, so the wideouts were covered extremely well. You know, the other thing I think Bo might have been mad about in that play with Steve Smith is that the defender saw Smith blocking him and went down to accept the block, and Smith got as low as he could. I don't know whether that's actually a block below the waist.
Third and 18, and Smith hits his man at the 50-yard line into Indiana territory, and that was Vince Bean, the young man out of Southfield.
This is the same pattern against the same defense that Indiana ran a moment ago that Brad Cochran knocked down. Smith goes back. Vincent Bean just runs a straight fly pattern down the sideline. He beats the underneath man, but he doesn't pick his hand up, and he's in front of the safety Hendrickson. That is the seam that Michigan found that Indiana couldn't find in the pass that Cochran knocked down.
Well, first down at the 49 of Indiana, Bean with his sixth reception of the 1983 season. He stays in there, and he is on the far side, the top of your screen, split wide. Garrett and Rogers, the running backs. And Smith couldn't find anybody, wanted to run, loses about four, and a flag goes down on that melee down there. Seista, the nose guard in there to grab him first.
I think what happened is we got a face mask penalty. It'll be inadvertent. Indiana came with a blitz to the strong side of the formation. Normally, Indiana only blitzes to the weak side or the split end side. And apparently, Michigan couldn't figure that out because they weren't seeing it in practice enough. The referee going over and explaining to Sam Weish exactly what the penalty is. Inadvertent face mask, I believe. Smith got caught in that blitz and couldn't get free. But the tackler, Zaisda, made the pull on the face mask, and that's a penalty. Can't do it.
Indiana coming to this ball game while that conversation still goes on with the official, the referee, Glenn Fortin. And Sam Weiss, Indiana against the rush, giving up about 179 a game. Again, that look at that last play.
You see, they came from the strong side. They had two people on the strong side blocking the blitzer. Now, here is the hand of 53, Seista, comes in. The left hand is on the face mask, and that is the penalty call. It's only 5 yards for inadvertent penalty, but it inadvertent grabbing of the face mask, but it gives Michigan a first down and 8.
Diorio comes out of there at guard for Michigan. Valoris back in there and might have brought a play in. Michigan in good shape now with first down and 9 yards instead of taking that loss thanks to that penalty. A little toss now going out to Rogers. A lot of daylight over there. Cuts back in. Gets to the 35-yard line. Boy, the defense was strung out on that left side, and Rogers trying to cut back in to beat a couple of men.
Once again, real good blocking by the tight end, Sim Nelson. Smith is forced to pitch immediately because that tight end is coming up real fast. Then Rogers uses his speed to get outside, and there's 95 Nelson knocking down Sigler. Now Sigler gets in on the tackle, but Nelson blocked him back off the ball 5 yards. You don't mind when a guy comes off a block 7 yards down the field to make a tackle.
First and 10 for Michigan, double tight end now as Caddis joins Nelson in there at the tight end position. Bean closing up the gap a little bit on the right side. Garthen's in motion, but instead the carry to the fullback. This is Garrett straight ahead, has the first down inside the 25. Block, the interior linebacker, bringing him down.
Michigan's doing a great job of play calling. They hit him outside with the option. Now they come back right inside. The fullback, he reads the block of the middle guard, sees that the center has taken the middle guard to the right, and Garrett cuts it back over the block. Good for good yardage and another Michigan first down.
3:33 to go in the opening quarter. Michigan on a march again, leading 7-0. That ball now at the 24-yard line. Little reverse option that time. Steve Smith carries and gets down inside the 15-yard line. Bean doing a good job of the block that time.
And once again, you see Michigan, after getting the big gainer up through the middle, they come back outside. Indiana was stacked up to stop the fullback, stop the off-tackle play. Michigan kicks it outside. They caved in the entire left side of the Indiana line. Smith had good room outside to make 9.
Just inside that 15-yard line. And need a short yard for the first down. Might have had some movement by Garrett. He carries. He's down close inside the 5. The flag goes down as Garrett goes to the 2. Boy, I thought he got off to a quick start that time. We'll see what the call is. Motion by Michigan. And Garrett seemed to be moving just a little bit.
Now, Michigan offensively is a little bit like a boxer here today, right? You know how they work the body and then go back upstairs to the head? Michigan is doing the same thing. They hit him back inside, over the center and guard hole, get good yardage through there, then they come back outside. Back and forth, back and forth. Indiana defensively has got to be guessing a little bit, and Michigan's catching them in that guess. And when they catch them right, the play goes for good yardage.
So that'll be second down now, the 5-yard penalty to the Wolverines for motion. That'll be second down and 6. Garrett and Rogers in there, but Steve Smith wants to go to the air, batted away. He was looking that time for Vince Bean, and it was just knocked away by, I believe it was one of the linemen of Indiana.
Yeah, it was the middle guard, Zizda. The middle guard actually doesn't even rush. He just kind of stays there and looks for the quarterback draw. Then he gets in the way of the pass. See, Dixon is blocking him. He's still on the line of scrimmage. He's not really making a rush. That's because Michigan has hurt them twice with the quarterback draw. So Zizda has been told, you hang back, make sure that you've got Steve Smith on the quarterback draw. Indiana now coming with 11 guys faking the blitz.
Giovanni Johnson wide at the top of your screen on a 3rd and 5. Bean, touchdown! Strictly a one-on-one as Bean beat Nate Porter that time, the cornerback, and took him to the end zone for the touchdown.
Grant, had to be an audible at the line of scrimmage because Steve Smith saw 11 people and a blitz coming. He had one-on-one coverage outside. Audible Bean one-on-one, straight fly pattern, lofted it up nicely. It's a little fade pattern where Bean starts about 5 yards from the sideline and then just kind of fades toward the sideline, and Smith throws to his spot. That one worked perfectly.
Vince Bean with his first touchdown reception of this season. Now try for the extra point by Bergeron. Decker holding. Bergeron's kick is up and good again. So with 2:27 to go in the first quarter, it's the Wolverines of Michigan 14, Indiana nothing. Well, if you're looking for total offense by Michigan in the opening quarter, rushing 102 yards, passing 53.
They've done pretty much what they've wanted to, Ray, and I think that's the thing that Bo Schembechler wanted to do coming into this game. He wanted to throw some. He wanted to make sure the offensive line got some work, and they have so far.
Green and Howard back, and Howard takes it just about 2 yards from the back line of that end zone. Automatic touchback, and Indiana will bring it out to the 20-yard line. On the other hand, Indiana's offense has moved the ball fairly well, rushing 32 yards, passing department 64.
Yeah, but I think the big thing is that Indiana has made critical mistakes, and that Bradley, the quarterback, has thrown twice into a crowd. We take a look at Michigan once again, using a little more time this time than their first drive, hitting a 20-yard pass to Steve Smith, keeping the ball for almost 4 minutes and going 66 yards. They have not been stopped yet today. Indiana defensively has got to do some gambling in order to stop Michigan.
Steve Bradley at quarterback. He puts Alex Green in a motion. On the option play, pitches out to Howard. And Howard, just back to the line of scrimmage, might have got 1 yard at the most. Sensi's over there to lead the way along with Hassel.
You know, and you talk about quick reaction and pursuit to the ball. Al Sensi, right, plays middle guard. That play went outside the end, and he was out there on the hit. That's just real good pursuit, good tough team defense by Michigan.
Do you think about a loop on that, or do you just say he's beating his man?
Well, he read the play, and it went on a pursuit angle, and that's the name of the game.
The fullback, Welsh, in motion now, and over the middle complete to Kennebrew. Kennebrew has the first down, close to the Indiana 35, mark it back to the 34-yard line.
The throwback pattern, most of the action is coming to the right. Kennebrew went on the left side wideout and just got into that crease between the linebackers, and there you see him trying to get outside. Tony Gant and Mallory have to come over, but that's a simple little pattern where Kennebrew just comes in, finds the area between those linebackers, and waits for the quarterback to read him.
Kennebrew has now hauled in 3 passes, good for 39 yards. Alex Green in motion that time. And we might get a flag on this one. We do, as Gunn was trying to break open in the middle, tripped up by Lott. Lott's feet just getting caught with Gunn when he started to make that turn to the inside.
Mike Bourne is over on the other side of the field, Ray, and Mike Bourne is down, injured. It looks like a leg or ankle injury. We can't tell from here. But the interference call on Lott gives Indiana a break.
Bourne receiving some more treatment right now on the far side of the field. As you take a look at the stats on Gunn, there's no doubt about it. As Jim referred to earlier, some of the Michigan coaches this week in practice saying that Gunn may be the best athlete in the conference. Meanwhile, Mike Bourne down on the field. Bourne, about two and a half weeks before the season started, was hurt in a scrimmage and had some knee problems, and then was all right by the time the season opened up, and hopefully we'll keep our fingers crossed it's not that knee again.
Well, Michigan cannot afford really many injuries more than their linebackers corps, because Tim Anderson and Andy Moeller, both backups, were injured. Now we have Mike Bourne down, and it does look like they're looking at his knee. Mike Reinhold and Jeff Akers are now the backups in there. So, you know, Michigan can't afford any more injuries. And it does look like Russ Miller, the trainer, is looking at that left knee of Mike Bourne. And Michigan cannot afford injuries. They really have been hurting their inside linebackers core. It almost caused Bo a couple weeks ago, you remember, right, to move Tom Hassel from the outside inside to help out because of the fact that they've had some injuries to their linebacking core. The outside backers seem to be all right, but the inside backing core has been injured. Both backups are injured. Mike Reinhold and Jeff Akers now backing them up for Anderson and Moeller, and now Mike Bourne goes down. So that's a critical position now. That is really getting to be a point of contention as far as Michigan's defense, because the key to their defense are their inside linebackers. They're the guys who make the most tackles in Michigan games.
Now Mike getting some help off the field at left knee. Mark Bourne, who has been Michigan's leading tackler the last two seasons and leading the way again here in 1983, the senior out of Columbus, Ohio. Of course, as we started the game today, a little different alignment in the linebacking corps for the Wolverines, but Rodney Lyles did not start, and we had Carlton Rose go to the outside.
Mike Reinhold in there, Ray, now to take Bourne's place, number 45. Mike Mallory will be the other inside backer. Hassel and Carlton Rose, the outside backer. So that is really the third linebacker at the start of the season, now playing in there for Michigan with the first unit.
Hoosiers at their own 44-yard line, first and 10. And Benson goes in motion. Benson making the reception and close to the 50-yard line. Just inches away from it. A long run for him as he started in motion to his left and then cut all the way back in the defensive backfield for that reception to the right side.
And you see the trainers working on Mike Bourne's left knee. I'm sure right now, great concern for the Michigan coaching staff because Mike has been such a standout for them. And again, depth is so key in a football program. Michigan's now got to have guys come on and fill the gap.
On a second and four, the fullback, or rather the tailback, carrying that dive and will be shy about a yard from that first down. They had a second and four. Bradley, by the way, is now 8 for 14 for 84 yards.
Now, you talk about knee injuries. Gary Moeller, the defensive coordinator on the sideline, just you saw him talking to Brad Cochran there. He had his own knee trouble in practice one day. Somebody came over and knocked him down, and he's been walking with a cane, and they're treating him. He's the only coach that gets taped before games.
Coming around is Smith. Well, that's Gunn on the carry. They had him at the wing back position. Hassel was up there to wrap him up. Did not get the first down. And that is not a new play for Gunn. Last week, he was their leading rusher. That's the end of the first quarter. We'll get all set now for the second quarter of play, and Michigan leading Indiana 14-0. Sam Weish wondering what's going on right now. He knows what's going on. His team is trailing by a score of 14-0. It's get all set now for the second quarter. Weish's record right now with Indiana, one win and a couple of losses. A punt formation by Indiana on a fourth and three. And instead, Indiana chalking some dice up, trying to go with a gamble for the first down. It'll be very close to the first down. I'll tell you, they almost lost up that play. They were going to send another player in there.
They were going to send Alex Green in, I think, to take Jack Walsh's position. Now, here it is. The snap is to the fullback, Walsh. But watch Michigan react. That's Akers, 33, reacting to the ball. And Jeff Cohen makes the first hit. Cohen is in there on special teams. He's one of Michigan's really good special teams players on kickoffs and punts. He reacted real well to that, did not leave his post, came right up and made the stick. And if they did not make it, you can credit Jeff Cohen with the tackle that really stopped him, because he hit him before the first down yardage.
Michigan takes over, and as Jim told you, young Mr. Cohen doing a job of planting the shoulder in there and stopping that big fullback, Jack Walsh, just inches away from a first down.
Well, it's a real good play by Cohen, because you don't expect a team this early in the game at fourth and three to be gambling like Indiana did. And Cohen, who is not big, not as big as Walsh certainly, stayed right home, saw it coming, and made the initial hit that kept them from getting the first down.
Kerry Smith in there now at tailback for Michigan, his first appearance of the game after having that big game last week against Wisconsin. 104 yards worth, 107 yards, and this time on his first carry, comes close to getting about 7 yards on the carry.
Look at the left side of Michigan's offensive line. They caved the entire right side of Indiana down. Kerry Smith is through for 5 yards before anybody ever got a hand on him. Indiana is very vulnerable outside, it looks like, to the short side of the field. Now they get a linebacker out there to make sure that doesn't happen again.
Second and three. The fullback going straight ahead. That was Dan Rice on the carry. It should have it up for the first down inside the 45-yard line of Indiana, close to the 43.
Watch them cut it back over. Now you see that he reads the block. Everything's going right. So he cuts it back behind the blocking, puts his head down, levels it off, and it takes three guys to bring him down. Now that's good, hard, strong fullback running.
Dan Rice on the carry and getting Michigan its first down. Giovanni Johnson's put wide to the right, Bean wide to the left. And a handoff to Kerry Smith, breaks a couple of tackles. Just rambles close to the 35-yard line. They'll mark it at the 37. Back to the 38 now.
Similar situation to what we saw last week in Wisconsin, Ray, when Michigan just grounded up front, knocking people off the ball. I'll tell you, when you're looking at the play-by-play stats after this thing, you'll see Michigan looking at a lot of second and fours, second and twos, and when you're a coach and you've got that many second down and short, you know that you're doing a job up front running the football.
On the option, Steve Smith, running away, and should have enough for the first down. Boy, he made a good cut over there on the left side. And he was taking the linebacker, Joe Fitzgerald, right with him.
Yeah, and the other thing about it, you wonder about Steve Smith. You know his speed is good, but watch the strength. Sigler, number four, is coming over and will hit him in the back. And watch how far Smith carries him. About 4 yards and gets the first down after he was hit from behind. Sigler helped him out a little bit with the impetus, but Smith was able to get his legs going and get the yardage before his knee hit.
Wolverines at the Indiana 32-yard line, first and 10. Kerry Smith on the carry. Inside the 30, close to the 27-yard line of Indiana. Leonard Bell, a cornerback, making the hit on him. You're right, looking back a week ago, Kerry Smith, by the way, on three carries now has 18 yards, but you got to just sort of smile to yourself and say, hey, are we in great position when we get a first down and we pick up 6 yards?
Oh, look at him now. They're looking at second and four. You'd love to be a coach in that position.
Rice banging his way close to a first down. The bottom of the pile for Indiana. Makes the tackle.
Interior line play, trapped by Humphreys. He gets over, and then real good running by the fullback as he hit in there and then spun. And when he spun off, he made a couple extra yards backing up. Michigan's going to get a measurement here, but Rice that time, really good job inside after he makes the initial contact, spins, keeps his legs driving, and it's good enough for the first down. And Michigan hasn't had a third down, I don't think, this drive, have they, Ray?
Exactly right, they have not. They haven't had to worry about a third down conversion at all. We have not had a punt in this ball.
That's where statistics will screw you up a little bit, because Michigan will be 0-for-0 in third down conversions. And who needs third down conversions when you're looking at second and two all day?
Michigan has picked up now a total of 134 yards on the ground. First and 10 at the Indiana 22. Steve Smith on the keeper. Oh, he almost had it broken open. Finally tackled from behind. And then there was Reb Brock to make the tackle.
Brock is a junior college transfer. The key here is Smith's legs. He almost gets brought down by a tackle, but the whole right side of Michigan's offensive line just caved in Indiana defensively, and when Smith got out of the grasp of that tackle, he had clear sailing, and with his speed, he's capable of getting yardage, and here he gets at least 10. They're going to measure once more.
Very close to the first down. They have it. Michigan with another first down, and now knocking on the door of Indiana at the 12-yard line. Smith has carried five times for a total of 44 yards, and this is the fourth first down of this Wolverine drive.
You know, Ray, they beat him up so much up front here. Like we said last week against Wisconsin, Michigan did the same thing with their offensive line. Now you're getting to a position where Indiana might be forced to gamble defensively. If they do, look for the audible and a pass, but they didn't.
Didn't do it. Kerry Smith hitting that 10-yard line marker and then maybe just inside.
Well, they came with two tight ends, and Indiana figured it was going to be a run. Now Bo is sending in a wide receiver, so they might be going to the air here. They got a second down and about eight. They get a first down at the 2-yard line. So it's going to be an interesting situation. If Smith sees them up there in a real tough 11-man, 8-man front, he may audible and go to Vincent Bean or Steve Johnson, possibly for the pass.
Bean on the right, Johnson on the left. As a wide receiver, takes to the fullback. Smith keeps it inside the five, close to the goal line. And just trying to get in, but Chris Sigler, the strong side safety, hanging on for dear life.
Smith looked like he fumbled the ball down there in close. Indiana thought they had it, but the referee signaled he was down. It's another first down. Michigan on the 1-yard line, knocking on the door, Ray, and it has been on the ground, total domination.
Fifth first down of that drive, another look at that fine carry.
Well, watch number 40. He is blocked. Now Smith gets outside that block. Now it's just great running ability. Turns it up inside, gets through that crease. Now Sigler does a good job of keeping Smith out of the end zone. But still, Michigan blocked the play well.
And Indiana calls for a timeout with Michigan at the 1-yard line of the Hoosiers. That'll give Michigan a little chance to talk over some more as they knock on the door of the Hoosiers. With 10 minutes and 57 seconds to play in the second quarter, Michigan leading by a score of 14-0. With Steve Smith over there conversing with his coach, and I'm sure that he is not going to say too much. He'll just listen. We hope that you'll listen to this message. Take a look. That's what you got to do to get a touchdown. 1 yard. 1 yard. Rice and Kerry Smith, the running backs behind Steve Smith. Kerry Smith on the carry. Close to the goal line. Yes, touchdown, Michigan.
Nothing fancy, Ray. Just a straight handoff to the tailback. The fullback blocks out. Look at Carthens, Miller, James. A little pull by the guard, Humphreys. And there's a little bit of a crease there, but when you only need a yard, good, strong, tough running by Kerry Smith. Not much of a hole there, but enough to get the yard for the TD.
Kerry Smith got to be a little bit happy. His first touchdown of the year. He's done some great rushing. This time it pays off, and he has his first touchdown. And Michigan leading 20-0. Bergeron in there to make it 21 if he can. Decker sets it down for him. The kick is up and good. So with 10 minutes and 54 seconds to go in the first half, the Wolverines of Michigan in command right now, Jimmy, by a score of 21-0.
I just think it's one of those times where Michigan's, again, figured if they can run that easily against Indiana, why throw it up? Why gamble? 76 Humphreys, watch him. He pulls out on the goal line. You don't see that too often, but he gets enough of a block on the outside backer. There's a tiny little hole, but again, when there's only a yard that you need to get in, Kerry Smith lowered the head, both hands on the football. He's about as basic a back as you can find in the fundamentals. He just does everything right. On the goal line, both hands on the ball, good body lean forward, then into the end zone. All he needed was a yard. That's all he wanted to get. He didn't want to break one through the back of the end zone because the only one that counted was that 1 yard to the end zone.
Well, Michigan has a roll with 361 yards on the ground a week ago against Wisconsin now. And in the first two quarters, 19 carries for a total of 156 yards, 8.6 per carry. That's eating it up pretty good. Slopey all set for the kickoff. Indiana sending their deep man, Green and Howard. And this one gets past Howard, goes back out of the end zone, and the Hoosiers will start it out again at its own 20-yard line. On that last drive by Michigan, taking 10 plays and really not using a lot of time. 4 minutes and 1 second.
Oh, again, right, when you're looking at those second down and fours, they didn't, what did they have, one third down play or no third down plays in the entire drive? So, when you're ripping off a first down play that's averaging 8 yards a time, holy cow, you can pretty much do what you want.
Starting at the 20-yard line, Indiana has started a series of downs from the 18, the 20, the 9, and the 20, and this time the pass is good to the 34-yard line. Lott over there to make the tackle on Kennebrew.
I I think Michigan content to give Indiana some short stuff. You see Carlton Rose tries to get in. Now, he should have never left his feet here, because if he'd have kept his feet, he might have had a shot of pushing the blocker back into Bradley. But the ball thrown out there, you see Lott coming up a lot quicker than he did against Washington. Michigan secondary playing tougher than they were against that Washington pass attack a couple weeks ago.
First and 10, Bradley over the middle this time and complete. And driven out of bounds at the 45-yard line. And that was Alex Green on the reception, the tailback.
Once again, Michigan taking deep drops against the deep pass. And out of the wing back spot, Green just comes right underneath the three linebackers. And a hassle misses the tackle. Then Green makes a good job of cutting outside. But Cochran does a good job avoiding the block, coming up to make the stop.
Hoosiers first and 10 at their own 45-yard line. Flag is down at the 45. The police on a rush there, and they had used a man in motion, which was Cook, not listed on our program.
He's another tight end. It looks like Indiana is content to stay with their game plan and go with the short passes. Chris Cook, number 90, the tight end in motion, was the man it was intended for. The left side, right side rather, of Michigan, DePolice, watch him. He'll take a little step, and it looks like he's the one that gets called for the offside. There is the anticipation. He couldn't get back in time, and the motion man comes across the formation, comes wide open in the flat, but the penalty was the deciding factor there, because the pass was incomplete as Bradley was getting some pressure. But Indiana's still looking at first and 5 because of the offside.
Sixth penalty against the Wolverines for 41 yards. Bradley on a slant pattern, firing complete to the Michigan 35-yard line. Say one thing about Bradley, good, quick release, and Gunn was on the receiving end. Lawton Cooper making the stop.
This is one thing you like about Dwayne Gunn, such a game breaker, and yet he'll be happy to go over the middle, catch passes in traffic. He's got two people on him, and he knows he's running into a safety. And he had good concentration, held onto that football, and Indiana, while offensively looking pretty good, they just don't have any points.
Another first down, the third in this drive by the Hoosiers, first and 10. That Gunn again.
As the tight end, I believe, or the wideout Benson. I'm not exactly sure. The numbers 89 and 88 look so much alike on the Indiana jerseys.
Benson.
Now watch, Evan Cooper is on the coverage. Now Cooper leaves Benson and comes back to this side. That leaves Benson wide open. Nobody is near him. You see Cooper there at the bottom of your screen, running back this way toward the camera. Mistaken coverage by somebody.
Mixed up in the backfield that time, as a running back, Salters, just about ran over his quarterback, Bradley, on that handoff.
Well, that's the first time we've seen Salters in the game, and Salters was listed as their starter, and yet we've seen Alex Green more than we've seen Salters, number 5, and when you're cold coming into a game, sometimes you make that mental mistake, you're a little too eager, and I think that's what happened there to both Salters and Bradley.
Reinhold and Hassel from Michigan in there to make the stop on Salters. The Hoosiers now second down and along 10 yards at the 24-yard line. Bradley, first time out of the pocket. And trying to hit Benson. Couldn't hang on to it. Also had Kennebrew over there. They were just about a yard apart on that pattern.
Now, that's the kind of thing that happens when you get a quarterback scrambling out of there. Now we have Tommy Hassel going down. Looks like he got his bell rung. He was in there on the coverage, but the reason there were so many people by the football, right, is because when Bradley scrambled out of there, the receivers are taught on a scramble, come back to the side of the quarterback and come back to him upfield. Both receivers on their pattern saw Bradley in trouble and came back to him. They came back in the same area. Hassel coming off now, looks like he'll be all right, but into the game comes a replacement. Carlton Rose is at one outside backer, probably be Scarcelli. It is, Jim,
yeah,
Scarcelli in the game.
12 for 19 for Bradley in the air. That's good for about 135 yards. Plenty of time this time. And Jennifer Kennebrew, a lot over there along with Gant to break it up. And he made that reception. Indiana had been right at the Michigan 2-yard line.
That's kind of a funny pattern because it didn't look like Kennebrew was really running hard down that sideline. And Tony Gant is reading the quarterback's eyes here. He's the free safety. Lott's got good coverage. Gant comes over to help, but Lott really had him covered well enough. But that's that two-deep zone where the safeties are playing, reading the quarterback's eyes, and when he sees the ball, he reacts to it. Now Indiana trying to get on the board with a field goal.
Doug Smith, who failed on a 47-yard effort, will try a 41-yarder this time. As a distance, and Indiana is on the board. Doug Smith has his third goal of this 1983 collegiate season, but Michigan has a lead in this ball game, 21-3, with 8:57 to go in the first half. Indiana all set to kick off to the University of Michigan. Chuck Raismick will have the kickoff duties. They send Rogers down there along with Kerry Smith, so we're seeing a couple of new kick returners in game number four this season as far as the kickoff is concerned for the University of Michigan. Raismick's kick end over end and taken at the goal line by Kerry Smith. 15, 20, close to the 25-yard line, and a flag goes down. Smith on a good return as he returns the first one back of the 1983 season. Last year had one return on a kickoff and got no yards out of it. Ahead clipping against the Wolverines.
Well, that really hurts because anytime you get the ball outside the 20 on kickoffs in collegiate football, you're in good shape because most normally you'll see kickers kick it into the end zone and you get the ball on the 20. See if we can see the clip. Kerry Smith makes a good move back inside, and there it is right there by Rick Rogers. He clips number 31, Ford, for the Indiana Hoosiers, and that's a mistake that I'm sure Rick Rogers will hear about when Michigan views the film tomorrow afternoon.
Brought back now to the 13-yard line of the Wolverines. First and 10 with 8:51 to go in the half, 21-3, Michigan leading. And this time Mercer on the carry. So Mercer gets his first call and gets close to the 19-yard line. Ryan Mercer, the junior out of Cincinnati. And as far as a teammate and running back, Greg Armstrong in there at fullback right now for the Wolverines. So once again, we have seen all of the running backs, the three deep running backs, the tailback and fullback for Michigan.
Interchangeable parts.
Second and 5. Mercer again. He likes that left side. First down across the 30 to the 31-yard line. Running over a couple of people and finally stopped by the safeties, Hendrickson and Sigler.
Real good tacking. Watch the left side. 73 James. There is a hole wide through there. Armstrong, the fullback, blocks the linebacker. Now Mercer's into the secondary. And all three of the guys in there on that tackle are secondary backs for Indiana. Two safeties and a cornerback. And when you get your cornerbacks and safeties making tackles, you know that you're in trouble defensively. You like to see those linebackers in there on tackle.
Carthens in motion. Mercer on a pitch. And good defensive work that time by Indiana. Moving up quickly was Fitzgerald to make the hit on him.
You notice that was the first time Michigan tried running to the wide side of the field. Indiana has got too many people over here. They don't have enough blockers. Now, Mercer's got to cut it back inside. Play took too long to develop, and that inside pursuit comes over, and that's their big tackle, Mark Smith, number 82, who's probably their best down lineman. And you got to get that play developing quicker in order to keep the pursuit away.
Second and 10. And Mercer is greeted there. Wow, is he hit. Incomplete. The flag goes down.
Now, they might call that ineligible receiver, but the ball was hit and touched first by Brian Mercer. Take a look. The screen, first of all, doesn't develop at all because there are so many people over there. Now, Mercer makes the catch. The ball is in the air, never touched the ground. Now, that is almost like a fumble, and anybody can touch it, I believe.
Got a call call for illegal man downfield on that. As you can see, as they tried to form that screen, it was Doug James who lost his footing and went down. By that time, he couldn't get back up and get in front of the intended receiver. Humphreys was out there. Oh, wait and see now. Backing up Indiana, a little bit of a march. I think they're going to now come back the other way and bring it back to just inside the 25-yard line. For all purposes, we'll mark it at the 25. So Michigan at its own 25-yard line. And third down and 15.
That's an illegal player touching the ball or batting the ball. And that was Doug James. Even though Mercer had the ball, it never touched the ground. Doug James can't touch. He should have probably batted it down. Even then, you get a penalty. I don't know what you'd do. If you're an offensive lineman, that's fun, getting that ball in your hand.
Sure, it's not that many times it'll happen. In a crowd, five guys around that time, incomplete. As they had Giovanni Johnson going in the middle there, but good defensive coverage by Indiana.
Yeah, and the thing is, Steve probably shouldn't have thrown this ball in there because the pass was absolutely no way that was getting through there. Kinnery comes up and makes the almost interception. He couldn't hold on, but look at the number of Indiana people around the receiver. You just can't throw it in and through that many people.
Bracken back to punt. The first punt of the afternoon for either team. Sigler back there deep, but the ball will not get that far. Down on the far side of the field at the 44-yard line of Indiana. So with 6:54 to go in the second quarter, it's Michigan 21, Indiana 3. 6 minutes and 54 seconds to go in the second quarter. Indiana possession now at its own 44-yard line. And thought it was going to be a quick little look-in that time from Bradley, intended for Kennebrew. But somebody either turned the wrong way or they weren't thinking right. Hassel doing a good job on some coverage over there.
Well, actually, Hassel was covering up the face of Bradley coming on a blitz. Bradley took a step back, turned around, looked to throw, and saw Hassel breathing down his neck and said, no thank you, and threw it away.
So second down and 10 for Indiana. Bradley wanting to go deep, goes to Gunn, a nice catch. That's actually thrown a little bit behind Gunn. He reached back, made the catch at the Michigan 38-yard line. Cooper covered.
Well, once again, this ball is thrown in that seam of the zone. First of all, Bradley's got great protection. Now Gunn finds the seam and reacts back to the ball. There you see Rose and Cooper both over there, and it's just that little area to sneak that ball through, and Bradley did a good job sticking it in there, and Gunn did a good job holding on and reacting to it.
Gunn's fourth reception, good for 52 yards. Bradley to the air again. And this time he picks out Benson, and Benson close to the 15-yard line of Michigan. Lott and Gant in there to make the tackle.
Good play by Indiana in that you see Michigan coming with a three-man rush. Now, they've got everybody blocked and double-teamed. Benson has got a half step. Now, Bradley throws this in there nicely. Hassel's got him one-on-one. You cannot cover a wide receiver one-on-one with a linebacker. There just isn't that much speed there.
Reinhold in there and out linebacker. Heel it out on the carry. This time it's Jack Walsh, the fullback, and gets across the 10-yard line of Michigan. Cooper and Gant in there to make the tackle. It'll be second down and about 3 yards for the first down. They can pick up a first down close to the 6-yard line of Michigan and then go from there on a first and goal.
Give Weish credit there on that call. Indiana's been strictly staying with a pass, and he comes back with a draw on first down and gets good yardage.
Sends Gunn in motion out of the right side. Flag goes down. A little high pass with Cochran covering on Gunn that time. To see what it might be. Michigan might have been offside.
You see Dwayne Gunn coming back now. His left knee is unable to straighten out. He has got tape on both the knee and the ankle, and that's why he's not really 100% yet. We've seen him here today, about 80%. He's playing very well. Illegal motion against Indiana is the call. Offsides against Michigan, probably. Offsetting penalties, right? So they'll replay the down.
Stay right at the 9-yard line. Second and three.
There you see the defensive tackle move, but then you saw Walsh, number 34 at the top right of your screen, also move. That was the motion penalty, and it was DeFelice, I believe, over there on the left side that jumped early. That's the second time he's done that this game.
Going to McNabb, the tight end. He's greeted at the 5-yard line, but might have enough for that first down as Hassel and Cochran make the tackle. Scott McNabb, tight end, senior out of Bloomington, Indiana.
Indiana tries to run a wide receiver to the same side out of that zone and take the cornerback away. Michigan's got to cover the motion man at that point. It was McNabb, the receiver, with a linebacker, and that's Hassel's responsibility. And down close like this, you got to cover a little tighter.
Meredith in there for Michigan to help out with that beef in the line. Good fake by the fullback and a timely pass from Bradley to gun in the end zone, and Indiana with its first touchdown of the afternoon.
I think it was last year or a couple years ago, I'm not sure, they scored on the same exact play. Gun is in at a wingback spot. They fake the play action and then just run Gun out into the open. Now, you cannot let this guy get this far open into the end zone. You've got to cover him tight. Michigan did not, and every time you let him have that much room down close, he's going to score. He's that good.
Well, Gun doing a great job on the reception that time, has his first touchdown of the season. Tell you, it won't be his last because he is a good one.
And he's only playing about 80% because he's got that bad left knee.
Indiana wanting to go for 2 points there. They're going to try to pass their way to it. It's good. It's cut the extra point, two of them. And is that young Mr. Gunn again? It is. Gunn on a two-point conversion from Bradley. So Indiana has closed the gap with 5:15 to go in the first half. Michigan 21, Indiana 11. On the touchdown and also on the two-point conversion. Back for Michigan, Rick Rogers and Kerry Smith. As Rasmick gets this one underway. It'll be Kerry Smith at his own 2-yard line. Wants the center of the field, 15. Now slants to the right across the 20-yard line, close to the 22. Hey, we're seeing, Jim, I think a little more harder hitting right now than we did earlier in this game.
Yeah, we are. Gunn starts in motion now. Lott's got him one-on-one. He comes underneath the linebackers. And on the two-point conversion, again, it's one of those pick plays where they'll run people around in there through those linebackers, and they almost pick off like a screen in basketball. They pick off the defender. That's the play that Gunn got open on for the two-point conversion, and Indiana's gambling, and it's paying off.
Michigan starting this one at its own 23-yard line. The pitch goes to Rick Rogers. Trying to get outside. A little bit of coverage that time. And moving in there was Hendrickson, the weak side safety. A game plan call from Michigan. Trying to get as much as they could outside. And as you said, Jim, in the early part of this ball game, they were successful in that. Then they got back inside.
Well, you get Indiana thinking outside, and you get to think them flowing to the ball outside and stop that option. Then you got yourself some opening inside. You see Indiana scoring drive, minute 39, 57 yards. The Hoosiers offensively have been impressive. Defensively, they've not been very good. Michigan counting on that again.
Steve Rogers faking that time, or rather Smith to Rogers, and Smith on the carry. Coming across the 35-yard line, close to the 38. Just a little fake that time to Rogers. He was out there by himself.
And again, I think the reason that play was run, Ray, was because the previous play, Indiana was flowing so well to the ball on the option to stop Rick Rogers. Michigan came right back with a little misdirection to take advantage of Indiana flowing so quickly.
Steve Smith, 7 carries, 62 yards. Michigan with a first down at the 37-yard line, their own 37. Armstrong on a carry, cuts back open. He was really trapped there at the 40. No daylight, and then came back a couple of steps. That was Rice, excuse me. Rice on the carry.
Mike Vorn leaving the stadium right now, back up to the locker room, and boy, we'll have to wait and get word on that knee and find out how serious it is. It would be a terrible loss if Vorn had to undergo surgery, and of course, that's the worst thing you think about when a player goes down with a knee.
Good fake. Rogers gonna have to recover. A little toss to him from Smith, a little bit behind Rogers. It was good enough to handle, but trying to take off and could not regain his composure in time. Didn't hang on to the ball.
Well, he had so much room outside. Smith pitches the ball early. It's a trap option, and the ball is pitched a little behind him. Rick should have handled it, but I think he was thinking about running downfield before he got the ball. You saw him turn it up real quickly because he had lots of room out there. He could see a big gainer, but he just didn't concentrate on the ball enough. And without the ball, a running back is average.
Third down and 9 for Michigan. Smith mulling over the air. And a flag goes down. Incompleted pass right around the Wolverine 48-yard line. That pass intended that time for Sim Nelson. We got a flag. Wait for the call from the official.
Well, they've been bouncing Vincent Bean around downfield quite a bit. When Vincent is out on a pattern, Indiana has been grabbing and holding and bouncing him around quite a bit down there. And I think, although I'm not sure, that we might get an interference call against the Hoosiers. Holding, defensive holding against Indiana, and that's an automatic first down.
Mark it off. Bring it upfield for the Wolverines to the 48-yard line of Michigan. First down. So a gift that time of the Wolverines. Michigan leading 21-11 with 2:45 to go on the first half. Wolverines would like to add a few points before they go into the locker room.
Well, the gamble by Weiss to go for two gave him a 10-point deficit, and he can tie the game with a touchdown, a field goal. Indiana coming with a blitz.
Rick Rogers on the carry. Rogers across the 50-yard line, close to the 48-yard line of Indiana. Rogers has been a busy young man today. Steve May and Fitzgerald, a couple of linebackers on the tackle on Rogers. Picked up 4 yards on the carry. Second down and 6 for the Wolverines. Rice and Rogers, the running backs. And Smith down the middle to Sim Nelson, in and out of the hands. They're going to rule an incomplete pass, an incomplete pass. Just the time that he had it and about ready to take his first stride, that's where he was greeted.
Well, Sim should have caught the ball. Catching the ball in traffic is the hallmark of the good receiver. He's open. Steve lays it up a little too high, but Sim's got his hands on it. He's bringing it down. Then he gets stuck by Hendrickson, and the ball pops loose. Referee rules incomplete pass. That may be a break for Michigan.
Nice to have Bruce Madja, our fine sports information director, University of Michigan, stopping by and keeping us up to date on things happening around the athletic department of the Wolverines. 3rd and 6, as Rogers now goes to that I formation, back as a tailback behind Rice. Smith going deep. And Giovanni Johnson in and out of his hands. Almost a touchdown effort that time. And into cover McBain to break it up.
Well, this ball's underthrown a little bit now. The long ball should never be thrown short. Now, Johnson's got the defender beat, and you can see he just sticks a hand up and touches the ball before Giovanni can make the catch. McBain really was beaten. They should have had 6 on that one if Steve had laid the ball up a little bit further.
4th and 6, Bracken back to punt. Ziegler back deep for Indiana around the Hoosier 10-yard line. And Bracken sends it down to Ziegler, the fair catch, and he takes it close to the 12-yard line. So we're down to 1:56 in the first half, and Michigan leading by a score of 21-11. And we hope that you'll join us next week. We've got quite a ball game for you as the Wolverines will be heading to East Lansing to take on the Spartans.
Yeah, that's the annual interstate bragging rights battle, Ray, and I think it's going to be interesting for you and I both because you're a graduate of Michigan State. I'm a graduate of Michigan. There will be no fights in the press box, but I imagine we'll see some emotional kids out there on the football field.
Well, we certainly hope that the Spartans come along after all those injuries a week ago. Back to this one, first and 10, and an incomplete pass. Bradley firing out to Smith on a quick pass and a quick release that time, right around the 14, but it's incomplete. It'll be second and 10 with 1:53 to go. Meanwhile, Indiana next week will be at home down in Bloomington. They'll be taking on the Golden Gophers of Minnesota.
Indiana, you know, after last week's poor performance against Northwestern, I would think that if they played like they are today against Northwestern, they'd have had an easy time with it.
Yeah,
they're playing much better.
Pitch to Solmers this time, trying to turn the corner on the left side. Gets close to the 15-yard line. Just across the 15, Gant was in there, along with Anthony Felice. So maybe 4 yards on that carry. Make it third down and 6 for the Hoosiers. And the Hoosiers not using that huddle. Trying to get right back there. Bradley, the quarterback. And this one was in a hurry out to Johnny Salter.
Now, Ray, I don't know why Indiana comes to the line of scrimmage immediately and doesn't use a timeout or doesn't use the clock. We've only got a minute and 21 left to play in the half. Now, Indiana's going to kick, give Michigan another shot with the football, and defensively, Indiana hasn't done a lot against Michigan. I would have tried to run that clock down a little bit more if I were the Hoosiers and not give Michigan an opportunity of more than a minute and 21 to come back with a football in decent field position.
Good point. Rasmick is the fellow back there to punt, and he's carrying slightly better than a 43-yard average.
And then throw an incomplete pass on third down to stop the clock in addition.
I tell you, that was also close to a lateral pass. Good kick by Rasmick. Sends Cooper back to his own 31. And goes out of bounds at the 43-yard line of Michigan. Wise choice by Cooper of stopping the clock and going out of bounds with 1:12 remaining in the first half.
And Michigan's got all three of their timeouts left, because when Indiana, I thought Michigan might call a timeout after their second down play to put them into third down and then save a little time on the clock. Michigan's got decent field position. They've got a minute 12 left. They could very easily get some points on the board here, and Indiana really gave them enough time to do it.
1:12, as we mentioned, to go in the first half. Michigan on top, 21-11. And Steve Smith trying to find somebody. Goes to Nelson, good catch at the 50, slips into Hoosier territory, very close to the 48-yard line, tries to inch it a few more yards down there, but couldn't do it. Just Foley is the one that made a stop on Nelson.
That's a real good catch by Nelson. He was in traffic there, and he held on.
Second and one. And again, going deep. Intercepted this time, intended for Johnson. Hendrickson, the free safety, bringing it back. And he goes out of bounds at the Michigan 48-yard line, taking that one away from Giovanni Johnson.
You just cannot throw the ball deep down the middle against the deep zone, right? Steve looks for Giovanni down the middle, and Indiana is playing a real deep zone, and that's the safety playing center field, Hendrickson, and he just steps up in front, and boy, that's a dangerous place to throw the football. I would have liked to have seen Michigan go to the sideline a little more, use the clock a little better, work it down enough for a possible field goal attempt. Now they give Indiana 36 seconds to try to get inside to give their kicker a shot at 3.
Gun in motion, first and 10 Indiana. Bradley getting away out of the pocket. And again, firing to Salters, too hot to handle, incomplete. But Indiana now with 31 seconds to try to get some points on the board if they can before the half comes to an end.
And Michigan gambling a little bit defensively there, coming with a blitz, sending some linebackers. Gun is the kind of guy you like to have zone coverage on so you don't get beat deep. In this situation, Indiana has shown they'd like to gamble against Michigan. They tried a fake punt. They went for 2 points after their touchdown, so we might see Gunn running a fly down the sideline or trying to hit him deep.
Michigan with that previous defense. Randall checks in at one of the defensive back spots. And this one intended for Chris Cook, the juggling act, and it's incomplete.
I'll tell you, we've seen about 3 or 4 Indiana passes over the last 5 or 6 plays where the players have had their hands on the ball, and it just looks like a hot potato. They just do not want to hold on.
Well, Cook that time trying to run without the ball. He was still trying to go downfield before it even got to him. 16 of 29 for Bradley, so he's gone to the air 29 times for a total of 180 yards.
And we're only in the first half. We may see him throw 60 times today, right?
Yeah, we were talking about 45, 46 times in this game. Third down of 10 for the Hoosiers. Plenty of time for Bradley. And overshoots the mark, intercepted by Cooper at the 7-yard line. That'll stop the clock with 19 seconds. And Bradley, that time, overshooting his deep men. The deepest man was Kennebrew.
Well, you can see Michigan's defensive secondary. They're playing way deep. And again, same situation as Indiana's secondary. Their safeties are playing center field. He tries to hit Kennebrew, but there's the center fielder, Cooper, reacting to the ball. He keeps every receiver in front of them, and when the quarterback throws, he reacts to the ball. Bradley overthrew, and Evan Cooper was there for the interception. I don't think Michigan can do much with this field position. They sure could have done a lot more with their position at the 43 earlier.
Cooper with his second interception of the season. Wolverines will play it cozy. First and 10, and a run out the clock now with 16 seconds remaining. I think we've seen our last play of the first half. As Michigan run it down to 7 seconds, taking plenty of time to go back in the huddle, and that's going to be it for the first half. So the Wolverines leading by 10 points as Indiana came back, and trailing now only 21-11. So don't go away. We'll be talking during our halftime activities. Right now, Michigan leading by 10. Halftime at the University of Michigan, and a little bit of a surprise. Michigan getting a little bit more than maybe they expected. 21-11, Jim.
Yeah, having a 10-point lead at halftime after dominating early and building up a 21-point lead. I think Bo's got a few things to say to him at halftime. They've got to get back and remember they're playing football, and they can't just go through the motions.
Michigan had a 21-0 lead, and they struck early with 8:58 to go in that opening quarter. Rick Rogers got the call.
Yeah, he did. Rogers made a great run on a option play. Smith makes a good pitch. Great block downfield here by the tight end, Sim Nelson, on Sigler, number 4. Then the great running ability of Rogers. He makes the cutback and into the end zone. That was Michigan's first touchdown. It was easy. They drove right down the field, scored two more, made it 21-0, and it looked like a blowout early. But I think maybe they figured it was going to be that way, and Indiana came back.
In a second quarter, after Indiana got on the board with a field goal, Michigan's lead was 21-3. Then Indiana went to work in the air.
Indiana has thrown the ball, I don't know, 30, 31 times in the first half. We may see 60. Their touchdown came as Bradley hits Dwayne Gunn, their great wide receiver. And you just can't leave Dwayne Gunn that wide open in the end zone. He started a wingback position, came outside and just ran for the corner. Bradley threw it up. Gunn ran under it. That made it 21-9. They went for two, made it 21-11. And Indiana is in this ball game. The statistics shows Michigan's dominance on the ground, but in the air, Indiana has been able to move the football. Whether you move it on the ground or in the air, the idea is getting points on the board. Indiana has scored 11 in the first half after being down 21-11, 21-0. I think that bodes well for the Indiana team. Their confidence has to be up somewhat. Michigan's got to come out and reestablish themselves in the second half.
Well, we'll find out what's going to happen in the second half after this brief timeout.
The second half of University of Michigan football is brought to you by Stroh Signature, the beer with something extra. And by America's largest carpet retailer, New York Carpet World, the better carpet people. And by Highland Appliance, everything you never expected from an appliance store. And Republic Airlines, nobody serves our Republic like Republic.
Our second half just about ready to get underway with Michigan leading by 10 points over a very surprising Indiana Hoosier football club this afternoon. Jim, what do you look offensive-wise from the Wolverines?
I think in the second half they'll do pretty much what they did in the first half. It was successful. Indiana did stop them their last two drives, but it was almost like Michigan stopped themselves. They had a couple penalties that hurt. They threw a pass for an interception, so I think that they feel they can run and move the ball and dominate on the ground, and I think Bo will go back to that. Looks like Indiana's covering the pass pretty well. Offensively, I don't look for anything major to change. There we see the deep men for Michigan, Rogers and Kerry Smith.
as Chuck Rasmick kicks off for Indiana and our second half underway. Taken by Rogers at the 5-yard line of Michigan. Trying to get outside, turns on his speed, steps just almost out of bounds over the 30, gave a little more speed, and gets it across the 40, but they say that he did go out at around the 29-yard line.
Well, Michigan does a good job getting the lane for him. Rogers comes up at the 5-yard line. Now, Michigan does a great job of blocking, funneling everybody toward the inside. Rogers moves up the field, turns the corner. Referee saw him step out of bounds at 30. Michigan still, though, good field position at the 28 following a good return by Rick Rogers.
All right, Michigan going to work now. Close to the 29-yard line, first and 10. And the first play from the line of scrimmage. Rick Rogers on the carry. Cuts back in there, some good footwork, and he should have a first down at the 39. Good blocking by James that time to spring Rogers loose, but he had some of his own speed, a little footwork there.
Well, he saw the hole inside, it was close, so he bounces it outside, then turns it up. And again, Sigler, who is their safety cornerback, is up there making the hit. I think Michigan's going to continue to do that, attack Indiana at the tackles and probably outside. Was successful in the first half. If you can get second down and four, keep doing it. And that's what Michigan has been doing all day.
Garrett in front of Rogers. Rogers again. Same play. Trying to cut back in. A little better work defensive-wise by the Hoosiers. Picks up a couple of yards. That was a first and 10 at the 39. Get close to the 41-yard line. Borders and Fitzgerald making a stop, and a Hoosier has been hurt on the play. Rogers now 9 carries for 72 yards.
Looks like Lou Cristofoli there down at the 38-yard line. Cristofoli is a starter who played in 1981 and this year was given the go-ahead to play football after a neck injury just a week before the season started. Cristofoli now injured, and I'd hate to see it be the same injury and that neck problem that he's had. In 81, he was a starter and had to miss last year. Take a look and see if we can see where Cristofoli was hurt. Rogers gets the ball, tries to bounce it outside in the upper part of the screen. Can't really see him get hurt, but when he hit the ground, he was down and it hurt, so it must be a neck injury, or because they're not looking at his legs. And he has had a situation where he has had neck problems, right?
That's right. You were talking, had a sit out all of last season. Weiss did not expect him to even come out for the football team this year, and all of a sudden a physical about a week before the Hoosiers started the practice, and they said, okay, green light, go ahead. So they continue their work on the linebacker, a junior from Louisville, Foley. While Michigan will wait, Michigan with a second and 8 when they get underway again. Well, next week, of course, the big one. Wolverines making a visit up to East Lansing, the Michigan State Spartans.
And Ray, one of the things that's interesting about that game that we'll be doing, it's the first meeting between George Perlis and Bo Schembechler. Bo's had his way with Michigan State since he's been at Michigan. He's only lost twice. And George Perlis made no bones about it in the spring when he was recruiting young players. He said, we feel that we've knocked the socks off of our competition up there in Ann Arbor, and I'm sure that they'll see some of that on the locker room walls in Ann Arbor. Also, for those people who cannot be in East Lansing, you can see the game, of course, on a replay at 11:45 in the Detroit area and 11:30 around the state. And we'd like to take this time to say hello to our friends outstate, Traverse City area, watching these games along with Flint, Saginaw, Bay City, a market where both Ray and I started our dwindling careers.
Of course, along on the Wolverine Sports Television Network. Nice to have you along. Well, it should be a big one, but they've got two quarters of play this afternoon. They're going to have to work on Indiana a little bit. Second down and 8. Second down and 8 for the Wolverines at the 41-yard line. And Smith with his first pass of the second half. Johnson out there to try to make the catch. A little bit low. Let's check it. It was Nelson. And a little bit low, couldn't hang on to it.
Steve didn't throw that ball well at all. The ball was down low. Nelson was open. All he had to do was stick it in there, and Steve just followed through, held onto the ball a little bit too much, and threw it into the ground.
Third down and eight. Tailbacks for Michigan up to this point have carried a total of 17 times for 109 yards. The fullbacks, five carries for 29 yards. Rogers in that wing back position on the right side. And Smith finds Bean at the 48 and driven out of bounds. Very close to the first down. In there to cover him up in a hurry, Hendrickson, the weak side safety.
Vincent probably should have tried to go inside. He tried to go back to the sideline, standing on the sideline. Good throw this time by Steve. Now watch, he tries to fake him and then go to the sideline. If he went inside, he might have fallen forward to the 50, but this is too close, and the officials are bringing the chains over to measure, see if Michigan got the first down.
Wait for the measurement. Very close. Had to get just about to the 49-yard line for the first down. First down!
Took him a while, didn't it?
Well, you're standing in front of your Michigan bench here with 100,000 fans. You say, well, we might give him a down. On the other side, well, who's to say? Well, Michigan on the first down here at the 49-yard line.
And Sam Weiss is out on the field telling the referee exactly what you thought. He said, hey, they were an inch short. How can you give them the first down?
First and 10 for the Wolverines, Dave Smith with Garrett and Rick Rogers. And Smith turning that corner inside the 40, close to the 36-yard line. Good fake there, but boy, when he made the corner, he was springing away.
Absolutely, and that is the key to the option. Once again, down the line of scrimmage, when he sees the defender go to take the pitch back, Steve Smith turns it upfield and he's gone. There it is. The defender went upfield to take the pitch back. There was nobody inside. Smith gets good yardage on first down. Watch the blocks inside. This is what holds up all the people inside. Dixon just buried the middle guard, even buried him so bad he got the offside guard.
Going straight ahead that time on a carry was Eddie Garrett, the sophomore out of Milwaukee. And Garrett close to the 32-yard line. Might have picked up four. That'll be second down and six.
You see that block by Dixon. When you see Steve Smith turn that corner, part of the reason he's so wide open and free is because that interior line is unable to pursue. Dixon buried two people over there. We saw Al Cinchich from Michigan make a tackle on the end. That time, the Indiana middle guard couldn't because Dixon buried him.
And instead, the tackle, Smith making a stop. Rogers on a carry, big hole. Finally, just hit for the turf by Chris Sigler, junior out of Grandview, Indiana. But plenty for the first down, right around the 25-yard line.
Nice blocking up front. Once again, Rogers sees the hole, back over the inside. Sigler makes a good stop, but again, good blocking by the interior of the Michigan line, opening up the big holes for the Michigan running back.
They keep Rogers and Garrett in there as the running backs. First and 10, Bean split wide to the right, Johnson wide to the left. On a first and 10. And again, Garrett going straight ahead for his fourth carry of the afternoon. Inside the 25, just about the 23-yard line. So second down and, oh, they're going to make it. 8 yards? And nine. Okay. Giovanni Johnson wide to the left out of your screen. Bean wide to the right, also out of your screen. That's Garrett, the fullback. And Rogers, the tailback carry. Bouncing to the 20.
Indiana gambling defensively and came with a blitz from the outside. Again, they gambled right that time because The crease opened up, but Rodgers got tripped up at the line of scrimmage. Now they're forced into a third and five situation. So Michigan's got themselves some work here as Indiana defensively is trying to hold up a little better against the run. Michigan been successful outside this drive. On this big third down play, they may try an option and try outside again.
Dennis Edwards, the outside linebacker, making a good stop that time for Indiana. Third down and six for the Wolverines. And going to the end zone and overshooting the man, Smith firing to Giovanni Johnson. Pretty good coverage that time by the cornerback, Jeff McBain.
Yeah, McBain did a good job covering up, and that was an audible at the line of scrimmage because it was the same kind of pattern that Michigan scored on with Vincent Bean catching the pass for the touchdown in the first half. This time, that little better coverage, Steve threw the ball a little bit too hard over the head of Johnson. But that was an audible because he saw him at the line of scrimmage in a blitz and man-on-man outside and decided to go try to beat him deep in the end zone and get it all in one play.
Dan Decker, number nine, a sophomore out of Roseville, will hold that ball for Bergeron. And Bergeron's kick about a 37-yard effort. It is there. It is good. So Bergeron has the job with his toe that time, and Michigan increasing the lead now to 24-11 with 11 minutes to go in the third quarter. Officially, that'll be a 38-yard effort by Bergeron that was good to make it 24-11. And Michigan increasing the lead just a little bit here with 11 minutes to go in the third quarter. Schlope all set to kick off to Indiana. And Indiana sending Bobby Howard and Alex Green back there. Michigan playing with a little more intensity, Jim, than they did at the closing moments of the second quarter.
Yeah, offensively, though, I think they're disappointed they didn't get in for six. But any points in that first drive is good.
Howard takes it at his 3-yard line, gets across the 20, close to the 23-yard line. On the return, 21 yards. So Indiana going on offense here at the 23-yard line.
I think the thing to look for here is what Indiana does offensively to see if they try to run the football or establish some kind of a running game. Because in the first half, all they did was throw 30 times. Michigan goes 72 yards, gets a 38-yard field goal from Bergeron, using up nearly 5 minutes on the clock. Ball control football for the Wolverines. Let's see what the Hoosiers do.
Hansley in motion that time on a keeper, this time from Bradley. And Hewlett comes in there to make the first hit on him, followed up by Gant. Notice one thing, of course. Mike Bourne has not returned that lineup.
Now, here's the option. It starts out to be an outside play, but Vince DeFelice got upfield and forced Bradley to turn it back inside the guards. The thing is, you've got to have linebackers in there staying home to stop that possibility.
Mike Rheingold in there playing the interior linebacking spot. Low pass that time from Bradley McNabb on hands and knees trying to come back to get that pass.
Well, once again, I think Bradley was forced to throw a little earlier than he wanted to because Carlton Rose coming on a rush was in his face, and Bradley really had no chance to complete that pass because if he waits for McNabb to complete the pattern, he's getting sacked.
Indiana with a third and one at its own 32-yard line. Howard and Hansley, the running backs. Hansley number 23, the Hoosiers. Howard on a carry. Good block by McNabb, the tight end on that right side, springing Howard loose. Has enough of the first down, out of bounds, close to the 42-yard line.
And Indiana running a little bit better. You watch Rhino, the linebacker, number 45 for Michigan, come shooting through the gap. Just didn't have the speed to get Howard as he turned the corner. Now Michigan is not stopping Indiana's run, I'm sure, like they'd like. Indiana did very little at all in the first half running the football. And here in the first half, or second half rather, the opening moments, they've come out and run fairly well.
Hoosiers picked up 44 yards in that first half on the ground. That's all they could do. Oh, all by himself, and he couldn't hang on to it. And he might have had nothing but the goal line in front of him. That pass that time intended for Gunn.
Boy, that's a surprise, Ray, because Gunn hangs on to just about everything. This is a timing pattern. Bradley throws right when Gunn clears the cornerback, Cochran, and he is in that seam overcoming from his safety spot is Cooper, but that pass was in there. Gunn should have held on, and they'd have had big yardage.
Second and 10 for the Hoosiers. Bradley to the air again. Now he gets Hansley coming out of the backfield. Hassel quickly in there along with Cochran, but it was Hassel doing the job as far as the tackle.
And again, a little crossing pattern underneath. Michigan's linebackers are taking that deep drop. You'll take a look. Watch. As soon as they see him go back, they are hustling back. Deep drop. Underneath comes the receiver. That is Hansley, the running back. That's a 5-yard gain. It forces them to third and 5, but Michigan's linebackers concerned more with the deep pass. That's why they're getting out of there so quickly.
Hansley on the carry and should have enough for the first down. Turned the corner pretty good, and I tell you, he looks like the quickest of all the backs we've seen in there.
Yeah, well, the thing that's impressive is when he did turn the corner, he turned it right upfield. Now, Michigan gets caved in all the way out here, which is kind of a surprise. They're coming inside with their outside linebacker. Now, you have to have somebody out there in contain to force that running back inside into the pursuit. Michigan got blocked that time. Indiana got the first down.
First and 10 at the 46. And a flag goes down, but Michigan on defense and really pouring through there on the blitz that time. Carlton Rose leading the way.
Nobody blocked Carlton Rose at all. He came right from his outside linebacker position, and absolutely nobody came to block him. And it's kind of an amazing thing because they had 12 men on the field. Now you think with 12 guys out there, they'd have found somebody to block Carlton Rose.
Michigan might have got bumped for too many players on the field too, maybe, huh? Oh, Bo's not happy.
Too many men on the field for Michigan. Apparently they didn't get a back off of there or a linebacker off the field in time. And Indiana is coming up to the ball. They're ready to play. And Michigan's got a game on their hands, right?
First and 5. Bradley over the middle. They'll rule that one incomplete or complete. Complete to McNabb, the tight end. First down at the 35-yard line of Michigan. Mallory and Rheingold.
Nothing fancy. Tight end just comes up over the middle. And Bradley puts it the only place that he can for McNabb to catch it low. McNabb went down to both knees. They got the first down. Indiana using that pass to negate Michigan blitz.
Gunn split wide to the right. They use Benson in motion. And the handoff to Walsh that time. 5-yard gain to the 30-yard line. Mallory in there on the tackle. Indiana picking up a hunk of real estate right now on the ground.
I think that's the most concern to Michigan coaches, the fact that Indiana here in the second half has run the ball fairly well against Michigan. And I think that is most discouraging to the Michigan defensive coaches.
Gunn on the left side, Kennebrew on the right side. And straight ahead of the fullback carrying Walsh. Might have had the back moving towards the line of scrimmage. He was in motion, and moving toward the line of scrimmage might have been Hansley.
Yeah, it was. Hansley was the motion man. Before the ball was snapped, he was heading toward the line of scrimmage. That'll be a motion penalty against the Hoosiers.
They'll mark this one back in all probability. The walk-off now that should take it back close to the 35-yard line. Second and 10 at the 35.
Now, in situations like this, Indiana has been going deep. We take a look at the penalty. Hansley starts forward before the snap. That's illegal motion. They've gone short underneath. Maybe they'll go deep here.
Bradley swings it out to his tight end. Picks up about 10 yards. McNabb, well, got 5 yards. For 5 yards on the pass, DeFelice and Cochran making a stop.
Give Vince DeFelice a good job on reading that pass because he saw the screen and came over from his tackle position to make the initial hit on McNabb.
Third and 5 for Indiana. They've had one successful third down conversion here in the second half. Could be a big play for the Hoosiers. Benson in motion. And Bradley on a great catch that time, a one-handed effort. And Benson going score. No flags down.
Indiana made a great play on third down, and again, that was one of those little crossing patterns underneath. Benson, first of all, comes from his wide-out position under the linebackers. Bradley throws it, and he makes a great one-handed catch. Now the great cut around Lott. The defensive back comes over Cooper and is blocked by a wideout. Good pattern, good catch, good throw against the tough defense. Michigan's in a real ball game.
Well, you saw some of those Indiana fans. They are happy. Here's Doug Smith trying for the extra point. It is good. So Indiana really giving a battle to Michigan here with 7:26 to go in the third quarter. Michigan 24, the Hoosiers 18. Well, a little concern on Michigan's part, especially Bo Schembechler and his men behind him. Doug Smith stays in there to handle the kickoff duties. He's a junior out of Hillsboro, California. And you saw the score there, 24-18, 7:26 to go in this third quarter. Kerry Smith and Rick Rogers back to handle the kickoff duties. Kerry Smith almost two-thirds of the way back of the end zone and no run out. Indiana giving Michigan a real tough battle here.
Take a look at the touchdown. Michigan secondary. Linebacker straight zone. Now watch him. He cuts right across the middle underneath the coverage. The linebackers are not there quick enough to cover him. Then the great cut outside. The block on Cooper, and he's in for the score. Good pattern in that they kept those linebackers back and then just dragged a pass pattern underneath them. Indiana's passing attack, a pro-style passing attack, and it's a good one.
Now they put Nelson as a wing back on the left side. And coming that way on the option is Steve Smith. First down, got Taylor. 45-40. Cuts back in, and right around the 35-yard line of Indiana, Nate Borders does the job of finally stopping Steve Smith.
Great run, and the best part about the play was the fact that it was blocked well. Here's the option. He fakes the pitch upfield. Good block right there. Could have been a clip by Sim Nelson. They didn't call it. Then Smith uses his speed. Here, I think Steve makes a bad decision to stop because he loses probably about 4 yards he could have had by trying the cutback, but a good job by Borders not to overrun either. So a mistake on Steve's part, good play by the defensive back.
That was his 10th carry for 130 yards. That time, Garrett, the fullback, straight ahead to the 30-yard line. You know, getting back to that block, Nelson was wise by blocking, of course, up above, around the chest area. Had he gone low at all, I think it would have been called, Jeff.
Yeah, I think so, too. Also, the other guy was falling down. The Indiana guy was almost on his way down anyway, but you know, if a referee wants to get picky, he can throw the flag on that. But Sim Nelson got away with one, and Michigan gets the big gainer out of Steve Smith.
Second and five for the Wolverines at the 29 of Indiana. Rick Rogers waiting for a block there that cuts back in and gets close to the 26-yard line. Wrapped up there by Dennis Edwards, the linebacker.
You know, as you look at patterns developed during a football game, Ray, you see that Michigan has done very, very well running into the short side of the field. When they run to the wide side of the field, they've had some trouble defensively, or Indiana has done a better job. So Michigan may stay a little bit more into the short side of the field.
Third down and a long 2 yards for that first down for Michigan. Rogers almost nailed, fought off that man, and got close to the first down. Borders brought him down. They had one slipping in there and almost made the tackle behind.
Yeah, they had penetration at the line of scrimmage. It looked like Doug James over there didn't get down quick enough. Rogers does a good job here using his strength, getting the ball over the 25-yard line. Now Michigan looking at a fourth down and a half yard, and Bo says, let's go for it, and you can see the reaction.
Well, you had a little brief, quick conference over there with Steve Smith and Bo. They decided to go for the first down. They're at the fullback, number 32, Rick Rogers, the tailback. Inches needed for that first down by the Wolverines. And Rogers pulls his way in for that first down. could see Garrett moving off to the right a little bit, and it was almost a mix-up with Steve Smith and Garrett.
Yeah, Eddie Garrett's route on his dive into the line was a little too tight. Watch him how he brushes Smith's shoulder. Reverses out. Garrett's a little tough. See how he gets out of the way real quick. And then Rogers carrying the ball with both hands, knowing he needs just the yard. Runs right in there and gets it. Big fourth down play for Michigan.
Mark it at the 18-yard line of the Hoosiers. First and 10 for the Wolverines. Trying to add points to their 24-18 lead. Rick Rogers, a lot of daylight up there in the middle. Then it closed up in a hurry, but it got close to the 17-yard line.
Once again, Michigan blocking at the point of attack is very good. And I think the backs are making good decisions because those holes are opening up at different spots. Rogers got to the line of scrimmage, saw it open up a little bit inside. Watch the cut. He makes the cut back inside right there. Good block, and then he turns it back upfield. Good decision by Rogers when he saw the hole develop.
Rogers has picked up 92 yards on 15 carries. Comes out of the game now, and Kerry Smith checks in behind Garrett in that I formation for the Wolverines. Second and five. Kerry Smith with the ball. Battling for that first down. Brock leading the way on that gang tackle by Hoosier. Well, on pile, he's very close to the first down.
Looks like we have an injury for the Wolverines out there, Ray, and I believe that's one of the Johnsons. Might be Gilvani.
Down around that 7-yard line. Measurement will occur while they work on Johnson. And the Wolverines have a first down. Gilvani Johnson. Saving that first aid.
Looks like it might be Gilvani's ankle. He has had some ankle difficulties this season. And his knee looks all right. I think it is his ankle. He's had some difficulties with the ankle. He'll be coming out of the game now. Boy, injuries, you hate to see them happen. And, depth is so very important in a college football program. When injuries start striking you and you get down toward the middle part of the season and you're into that real Big Ten grind, you just can't afford to have the injuries to key people.
Spence Bean is the lone wide receiver, double tight end, and Nelson and Carthens for Michigan. First and 10 at the 12 of the Hoosiers. Pitch out to Kerry Smith. Cuts back in. Touchdown! Good blocking from Nelson again. And Kerry Smith with a second touchdown of the afternoon.
And a real good audible from Steve Smith. I'm sure that he called that play at the line. Indiana came with an 11-man blitz, actually 8-man blitz. There was nobody on the corner. Smith made a great cut inside Eddie Garrett, who threw the block to get him free to the 5-yard line. And then Kerry just turned it outside and got himself into the end zone. That's a great call by Steve Smith. Facing a blitz, he went the right direction. I'm sure that he called that at the line of scrimmage.
That'll make it 30-18. And Indiana has called a timeout to draw the try for the extra point. So with a 30-18 score before our extra point attempt, let's pause for this message. A Bergeron has not moved out of the field, so Michigan going for a two-point conversion here. First time in 1983 for the Wolverines. Bean in motion. Smith trying to get in, and the officials say no. He was down before he got to the goal line. Good work done by Indiana. That might have been Fitzgerald in there.
It was. The linebacker, Joe Fitzgerald, came up and stopped him, right? That was the second time they went for two. They went for two one other time,
right.
I recall. And the touchdown is a good call here from Steve Smith. See the blitzing coming? Everybody's coming. Eight men. There are only three secondary backs. There's the cut by Kerry to get him beyond that linebacker. And Eddie Garrett threw the block on number 46, Jeff McBain. Smith does a good job making that audible call at the line of scrimmage and getting the play running in the right direction against that blitz. That allowed Kerry Smith the room to run, and then when Kerry made the cut behind McBain and got the block, he was free and clear into the end zone. Michigan missing the two-point extra try, and he wanted to do that, Ray, because he wanted to get it back to a 14-point difference. Now it's just 12, a touchdown and a touchdown with extra points, and Indiana's ahead.
Well, the Michigan defense will go to work here. Slopey all set to handle the kickoff duties for the Wolverines. They've got 3:29 left in the third quarter. Indiana, with two men back at the goal line, in Bobby Howard and Alex Green. This will be Howard. Battles up to the 25, close to the 29-yard line, and a nice return by Howard, who came into this ball game without a kickoff return for the year.
Real good return by Howard, because Michigan had a line drive kick, really not a lot of hang time. So we take a look at Michigan's scoring drive, and it was a big drive. They were only up by 6 points. They had to get a score in there and match Indiana's touchdown. They did it, used almost four minutes on the clock, usually staying on the ground, and Michigan has dominated on the ground. But meanwhile, another Michigan player has gone down to an injury on the special teams.
Tony Gant, one of the defensive backs for Michigan, being worked on right now. Again, on a kickoff return by Howard. And really turns on the Jets when they got around the 15-yard line.
Yeah, well, what happened, Ray, is that in here is the wall that forms, and Tony Gant, number 14, comes in right here, and you see he gets twisted around. Hangs on for dear life, though. Don't know what exactly happened. He's up and running, so I don't think it's his legs. I just think he had his bell rung a little bit.
Another member of that special team, you saw number 22, White, was hanging on there, and he actually made some contact with Gant.
I'll tell you, there's, you know, the special teams, especially those kickoff and punt teams, are the kamikaze squads, because they run down there as fast as they can, and they talk about football being a contact sport. It's actually a collision sport.
Like I heard that someplace.
I think somebody.
Contact sport was a social dancing.
That's right.
First and 10 for the Hoosiers of Indiana at the Indiana 29-yard line. Bradley getting a rush that time, avoids it, scrambling for dear life. And then Cohen makes the tackle right around the ankle.
Jeff Cohen in there for Tony Gant, who sometimes come in when Michigan goes to the nickel. So Michigan is expecting Indiana to throw a lot. He should not have gotten out of this rush by Michigan, but he did. He's a fairly decent mobile quarterback, but the one good thing is the Wolverines react up to the ball fairly well. He had a lot more room, and it closed up in a hurry, and Michigan did a good job keeping him to just a five-yard gain.
Well, Rose was giving chase to Bradley that time, applying some pressure. Now Rose moves to that left side at second and five of the Hoosiers. Bradley with lots of time this time. Rose was hard in. Into the hands of Cooper, and he has his second interception of the afternoon at the Indiana 45.
Now, that's what Michigan needed, was the big play defensively. And you can see they're coming. Carlton Rose from his linebacker spot coming outside. He is blocked well, but Bradley feels pressure, moves to the left, throws high. Here's the tip drill. Evan Cooper playing his safety in his zone, gets the ball, interception. Michigan gets the big play. And once again, thank that tip drill that every defensive back runs probably till they're tired of it in practice. But in the game, it comes in handy.
The former offensive lineman, when you were playing, wondered what they were doing over there, right?
We thought they were playing volleyball.
First and 10 for the Wolverines. 2:35 to go in the third quarter. Great field position as they use Nelson in motion. The option play tossed out to Rick Rogers. Oh, Rogers is dumped as Nelson was trying for a block over there. Couldn't get back to get his man. And Hendrickson comes in there and makes a fine stop.
Now, Nelson comes in motion, and he has got to block the cornerback. Now, I think Sim has got the guy pretty well handled. Now, Rick's got to make a cut here. Sim Nelson missed the block. I'm sorry. I'm not sorry, but
you want to give him credit for it.
Yeah, if Rick would have cut that buck back up inside, he might have gotten some yardage. But Sim Nelson should have kept contact with him out there for that play to go.
Got 1 yard on that last play. Second and nine. And over the middle, a little bit low. intended for Vince Bean at the 30-yard line, incomplete.
Michigan, Steve missed the tight end. Nelson came across the field, very similar to what Indiana has done with Dwayne Gunn and Benson, in that they'll run underneath the coverage and kind of drag across the pattern. And he has come open on a couple of occasions. Steve is looking more downfield to his wide receivers, but the Indiana linebackers are dropping so deep that the tight end has got to come into this passing situation here, or for that matter, a wing back or fullback.
Dan Rice in there now as a fullback. Steve Smith wanted to run, started to run, and then was cut down when Zizdow
came in there and did a job, the nose guard.
Good coverage by the secondary for Indiana. Nobody was open. Steve, if he was going to scramble and get out of there, should have probably done it a little quicker, because he looked a little tentative when he decided to go. And when you hesitate that one momentary second, you give the defensive lineman a little bit better shot at coming off the blocks and making a hit on it.
So that means it's fourth down and still a long 9 yards to go. Bracken checks in. This is what he's done on his two previous punts. Indiana sends one man back, and that is Ziegler at his own 10-yard line. Signaling for the fair catch, but that ball will carry to the end zone, bouncing in just about a yard inside. But the automatic touchback, and the Hoosiers will bring it out to the 20-yard line. Some young fans here today, too, enjoying this one.
Now, why in the world would he be wearing a green shirt here in Ann Arbor?
I don't know, but he had
that. That's next week, isn't it?
I think so. He's a week early. Sam Weiss, the head coach in the first year at Indiana University. And he's got some catching up to do for his ball club. They're down by 12, 30 to 18. With 59 seconds remaining in this third quarter. Bradley did go to the air again. He wanted to go over the middle, had nobody there. Instead, on a comeback pattern, successful for a first down at the 34-yard line, is Gunn.
And Dwayne Gunn is limping a little bit. Looks like he hurt that left ankle or knee again. But I want to tell you, Dwayne Gunn made a great play there. He saw his quarterback in trouble. We talked about it earlier in the game. When you see, as a receiver, when you see your quarterback in trouble, you've got to break your pattern and come back to the ball. Dwayne Gunn was covered like a blanket by the two outside defensive backs, saw the quarterback in trouble, came back, made the reception for a first down.
Bradley on a first and 10. And on the carry this time is Walsh, brought down by Cooper. Gant is back in the ball game, so that's good news for Michigan. And that gain was up to the 45-yard line.
Good draw play in the sense that Michigan has seen nothing but the quarterback going back and throwing. All day long, that's all he's done. So they come back with a draw play. Michigan's got their ears pinned back on a fast rush, and that's when you get hurt by the draw.
Green this time trying to get outside. Cochran coming up quickly, and that'll be at least a 3-yard loss.
And give Vince DeFelice some credit, too. He was out there. Now, watch Felice number 90. He is out there, and he forces Green back outside. He's fighting two blocks. Right there, he falls down. Now, Cochran comes up. Green wanted to cut that back inside and couldn't, because Felice was there to stop him from going back inside, and that gave him the opportunity to Cochran to get him outside.
Time has run out of the third quarter. We are all set for the fourth quarter. Michigan on top, 30-18. Underway now, fourth quarter, second down at 13 for Indiana. Hand off to Smith. And nothing happening that time, as Michigan's left side, led by DeFelice, doing a good job against that run.
Same play they tried to run at the end of the third quarter. Michigan came up, Felice again, fought through the double team, got in there and tripped the runner up. He had great support coming up from Hassel on that side too. And an Indiana player now is down. We've seen a number of injuries in this ball game, and that's distressing. And either team, you don't like to see these players hurt. And another Indiana player by the huddle goes down. It looks like he's just got leg cramps though.
And they're working on right now the right tackle, Sikora, 275-pound senior out of Youngstown, Ohio. Indiana, once the injured players are up or off the field, will be faced with a third and 14. And in the second half, they have been 2 for 2 on the third down conversion. Meanwhile, a little extra time for the defense of Michigan. So the treatment continues. And I think that other fellow that is out of our picture, just about 15 yards, 10 yards away to the left of Sikora, is gone on the ankle again. But this is Sikora. They made a switch here coming in this ball game. Giannakopoulos was scheduled to start at right tackle today, and Bob Sikora, after 3 days of hitting down at Bloomington, got the starting call. Meanwhile, more first aid for Indiana, just a few feet away. Sam Weiss got to worry about numbers, I would think, healthy numbers for his ball club.
That was George Giannakopoulos there, Ray, 69, the other man that was injured. He is in the game now, and he's all right. It looked like he just had a leg cramp, and they worked it out.
Benson and Kennebrew put wide to the left side. Here's Gunn on the right side. One back is Walsh. And intercepted by Hillman. His first interception of the season. Right to him.
Ball should not have been thrown. Third down situation. Bradley goes back. He's getting a big rush from DePolice. Throws it way too early for Benson. Hasn't even completed his pattern. And there is Hewlett, who had Gunn man-to-man for about 5 yards. And then he released Gunn to the deep zone. And then Hewlett reacts back inside to the flat. Good interception by Rich Hewlett. Ball probably shouldn't have been thrown, but it's a good break for the Wolverines.
Michigan with 4 interceptions so far this afternoon. One by Mallory and a couple by Cooper. First and 10, and the Wolverines now into Indiana territory across the 45-yard line by Rice on the carry. Fitzgerald, the linebacker, on a stop. 4 yards on that carry, make it second down at 6.
And Ray, the pattern continues. Michigan is running their offensive plays. They're running everything, well, almost everything, into the short side of the field. Indiana must be overshifting to the wide side because Michigan's been able to run successfully to the short side.
Rice and Kerry Smith are the running backs for Michigan. Steve Smith on the keeper. Smith, when he makes that turn, had Sigler around him, but he picked up a good 3 yards after the hit was made.
That's the strength of Steve Smith. You know, we know how quick he is. We know what a good runner he is, but he's also a strong little guy. He runs very hard. After he's hit, he's picked up a lot of yards.
Smith has carried for a total of 134 yards, Jim, on 12 carries this afternoon. And he should now, with that, be ninth on the list, at least ninth on the list, of in the Big Ten for yardage in a career. Rice breaking up the tackles, head down, extra power, has a first down and close to the 30-yard line.
You're exactly right, Ray. That's all it was. Good blocking up there to give Rice the crease to get through, but the rest of it was on his own.
5 carries for Rice for a total of 27 yards. Carthens comes out of there for Michigan.
Once again, there you see Rice with the ball, head down, both hands on the ball. We even got a fake on the cameraman as they followed Steve Smith down the line of scrimmage.
Rice and Kerry Smith, again the running backs, being split wide to the right. Now they're trying the left side. Smith somehow avoided two men and finally tripped up around the 30-yard line. That might have been Leonard Bell coming in there. I'll check it. It was Hendrickson along with McBain.
Give Steve Smith credit for getting something out of nothing there, because that option play was nowhere. Two people inside, and this is just Smith breaking one tackle, forcing another guy to miss, and then diving through for a couple extra yards. That's just great athletic ability for Smith to be able to do that.
Kerry Smith goes in that wing position on the left side. Rice, the lone running back behind the quarterback. And Sim Nelson, a little circus catch of the 18. How do you do? Boy, he's impressive.
Yes, he is, and that pass pattern has been open all day, and I think the Michigan coach has finally told Steve Smith, go to the tight end. He's coming open. Kerry Smith is at a wing. He comes and curls to the right. Sim Nelson is on the right side, comes and curls to the left. Wide open as they're in between the linebackers and the deep backs.
Well, we talk about Nelson catches today and this season, but he has turned in a fine blocking performance too in this ball game. First and 10, Wolverines. Kerry Smith turns the corner. Hello, third touchdown of the afternoon.
That's great running. And again, Ray, it was into the short side of the field. Michigan caught Indiana, again, overshifting to the wide side. Watch it. When Kerry Smith gets the football, he doesn't belly out at all. He bellies out a little, then he's upfield. Now, here's the great running ability. Fighting through and staying in bounds to get into the end zone. Good run. Good call into the sideline away from the power of the Indiana defense.
Well, Kerry Smith, having quite a day to remember, got a touchdown in the second quarter and has picked up one in the third and now here in the fourth. They'll go for the two-point conversion attempt again, failing on the last one. Kerry Smith and Rice being in motion. And Steve Smith firing and incomplete. A little bit behind Carthens, who was over there on a one-on-one. Been on the mark, I think they would have had to. Instead, Michigan will settle for this lead right now, 36-18 with 11:42 to go. Yeah. All set for that kickoff now, Michigan leading 36-18. Slopey will do it again. And meanwhile, Green and Howard will attempt to do it again for Indiana.
I think Slopey would like to get this ball a little higher and get a little more hang time for his defenders to get under it. Last kick he didn't, and Indiana returned it past the 30.
Drills it deep. And taken that time by Howard. No run back. Hey, by the way, on that last drive, we saw Smith running and passing. And Steve, with 247 career completions, needs only three more now to tie Leach.
Yeah, and here is the touchdown, and Kerry Smith has got a huge hole. You can see it right there. Now, here's the great running. He fights off with an elbow inside, stays inbounds, and runs through the tackle into the end zone. That's a back, what a back has to do. He's got to level off and force his way through so he stays inbounds with that inside arm. Michigan goes 48 yards and takes the 36-18 lead.
Lane gun in motion. Bradley, some catching up to do now. The rush is on, and he is sacked by Hassel. Hassel breaking through and driving him to the turf.
Watch Hassel just fight through this block. And we talked about how tough Tommy Hassel is. Jack Walsh goes on a pattern, but this is a tackle that Tom Hassel beats. Those guys are 260 pounds out there. Hassel is just a tough nut. He goes through anybody and anything, and when he's on a blitz, look out. If you're the quarterback and you see Hassel coming, if I were the quarterback, I'd call another play.
The lightest man in that offensive line from tackle to tackle is 260 pounds, and that's Van Dyke, the center for Indiana. Again, Bradley has to get rid of it in a hurry. He goes out to his tailback, Todd Hansley, and Hewlett is there to greet him along with Mallory.
Michigan defensively doing a lot better job, it seems like, Ray, in the last two Indiana series. They've done very well holding Indiana to those short patterns. They've really stuffed Dwayne Gunn at the line of scrimmage, and they haven't let him get free and roam around in that secondary.
Third down at 17 for Indiana. Reinhold has started back in, has come back into the lineup now for Michigan, and Hewlett has come out. And this will be the 41st pass intended for McNabb that time. It's incomplete. So Bradley now 22 of 41 through the air. And last week threw 44 times against Northwestern. Could get a sore arm that way.
And guess who was coming on a blitz?
Who?
Hassel.
All right.
And he was right in Bradley's face when he threw that one and actually forced him to throw it early.
He's not tired yet, that's for sure. Indiana's picked up, like, 247 yards in the air in a passing department. Only the second punt by the Hoosiers this afternoon. You saw Cooper standing back at his 47-yard line. And waiting for this one from Rasmick. and it goes out of bounds in Indiana territory. They'll mark it at the 44-yard line. So we got a timeout, 10 minutes and 8 seconds remaining. The Wolverines leading the Hoosiers of Indiana, 36-18.
Dear Republic Airlines, I travel 4 or 5 days a week, and I...
Greg Armstrong checks in for Michigan at the fullback position. Mercer, the tailback, number 41. Armstrong is 34. It's Mercer on the carry. And boy, going straight ahead to the 40-yard line. Looked like he was going to be tripped up at the 45. Just kept going, and finally Hendrickson brought him down.
Michigan, I'm sure now, will be content to stay on the ground, let the offensive line go to work inside. Here it is, handoff deep to the tailback in the backfield. He picks his own hole, and they're ripping off yards at 4 and 5 yards at a crack. And again, Ray, when you're looking at 2nd and 5, you're not doing too bad. Any coach in the world would love to be in 2nd and 5 all afternoon.
Carthens checks in. The Michigan will employ a double tight end. Carthens on the left side, Nelson on the right. 2nd and 5. Mercer again. Just will be about shy of a first down by about a yard. Brock making a stop for Indiana. Mercer on 5 carries now, close for 27 yards, 26 yards officially.
Has it seemed like a quiet crowd here today, Ray? Has it seemed like people are really jacked up for this one, you know? Next week, you know they'll be going crazy in East Lansing when the Spartans and the Wolverines square off, and you'll be able to see that game here on the Wolverine Sports Television Network. But today, it's just been kind of a quiet afternoon, and Michigan has had a little trouble, but they're getting it done.
Need 1 yard. Mercer will have to fight for it. See if they rule that Mercer was down at the 35-yard line. Got to get close to the 34.
Indiana really does a good job here at the point of attack. Brian Mercer tries, but he had no hole to go through. He just is diving and grabbing and fighting for every little yard he could get on that 3rd and 1, and Michigan did not get it. Here on 4th and 1, they're going to go for it.
They have tried it on a 4th before, one time in this ball game, and been successful.
I bet you money they run to the short side of the field, and I bet they run an option.
That's a lot of betting on one play. We'll see what happens here. 4th and 1.
Wrong.
Mercer. He has it. First down, Michigan.
It shows you how much I know.
Oh, no, you know a lot. I know that.
Well, you know, they've done it so well. They've been successful going to the short side of the field. But this time they just decided to power it out there, do no finessing at all. And Indiana's coming with a fire game. They fold the guard around outside, and he knocks down the end. Mercer cuts it back up inside. He knows he's only got a yard, so he doesn't do anything fancy. Knocks it outside.
Edwards, outside linebacker. That is Dennis Edwards, a senior from East St. Louis. Been hurt on that last play. Steve Smith at the bench to talk with Bo.
Probably talking about the defense that Indiana's been running. They're gambling a little bit. I mentioned fire game a minute ago. That's when they'll take a linebacker from his outside position and they'll run him right across the head of the tight end, really pinching down, forcing everything inside.
Well, we've got timeout right now. 7:54 to go. Michigan leading 36-18. Injured player for Indiana, Dennis Edwards, going to the bench under his own steam. He is okay. So it's 1st and 10 now for Michigan at the Indiana 31-yard line. Mercer getting outside. And close to that first down. Finally driven out of bounds by Borders. Close to the 20-yard line. Now mark it at the 22. Might be just shy of that first down.
Looked like Mercer wanted to get outside all the way. It was a play designed to go off tackle. But again, Indiana is pinching inside. Their outside people are working hard to clog up the middle. When a back sees that happening, he bounces it outside. There's nobody there for contain. He can turn the corner and get good yardage.
Mercer down for 23 yards on 5 carries. And going straight ahead on a carry that time is Greg Armstrong. Across the 20, has the first down. Might be close to the 17-yard line. better than 50 yards on this drive, right around 55, 56 yards on this drive by Michigan since taking the punt.
The messenger guards for Michigan, Jerry DiOrio and Art Valordis. Valordis now coming into the game. Bo sometimes has trouble finding which guy he wants to send into the game with the play. Depending upon the situation and what kind of a formation he wants, he has guards, wide receivers, and backs in there, and he doesn't know which one to put in for that certain play.
Steve Smith on the option, cuts back in, gets down to the 15-yard line. I want to go back. Why is that? That he has to make a decision on which guy to bring in the play.
Well, because in a situation like this, he may want a different formation. And instead of Jerry DiOrio, who he's sending into the game now, he might want to send another back or another wide receiver. Because he wants, say, two tight ends, he would send Milt Carthens in. Because he's already got a guard in the game. If he wants two wideouts, or if he wants a wideout playing a wing or triple receiver, he would send a wide receiver in. Depends upon the formation and what kind of play he wants to run. Depends upon what player comes in with the play.
Now you saw what Steve Smith had been doing on the ground. Now we'll see if he's going to do something in the air. He fires, intercepted. He waited a little too long that time. He was trying to go to Steve Johnson in the end zone, and it was picked off by McBain of Indiana.
Steve Johnson was open in the end zone for probably 5 seconds. Right now, Steve Johnson is open. Steve doesn't see him. He doesn't see him. Now he's covered. And Steve throws the ball, and it's intercepted.
Well, the turnover gives the ball to Indiana. The Hoosiers will line up at their 20-yard line coming out of that huddle. The speedy wide receiver gun split wide to the right. Going to gun, underthrown behind him, and almost intercepted by Michigan. And then there was Lott covered on a play, and he almost had the interception.
Looked like a mix-up in the pattern. Dwayne Gunn cut the ball upfield like a post pattern, and Bradley threw this outside like a flag pattern. You see where Gunn was, the ball was to the sideline side. I think they missed up the pattern, and Gunn or Bradley, one of them, made the mistake in which pattern to run and which ball to throw.
Second and 10 for the Hoosiers now, still at the 20-yard line, their own 20. Plenty of time. Hansley on the reception, and he pays for it. Makes the catch just about the 24-yard line, and then Carlton Rose drilled him.
And Cam Cameron is in at quarterback for the Indiana Hoosiers. Cameron, the backup to Bradley, and he's quite a story in himself in that he is a graduate of Indiana already. He is in graduate school in the business school at Indiana and a former basketball player for Bobby Knight.
Played a couple of seasons for Bobby's team. He was a reserve on that basketball team. He's a senior out of Terre Haute. They say in the last home game, the fans were cheering for him to come on. They were having problems. So period here in the fourth quarter with 5:24 remaining in the ballgame. And this one to Hansley, complete to the 46-yard line. Gant over there to help out along with Cooper. I'm impressed by Hansley. I think he's got great speed.
Yeah, he does. He really looks good, as we saw a bird's eye view of this one. There you see the underneath crossing pattern. And if you notice, Cook, the tight end number 90, was standing around in the middle also. And Cook was the guy who, while they say, was picking the linebackers. He came across, holds his hands up. It's an illegal pattern. It's a very tough call to make for an official because he could very well be on a pass pattern. But it's a fine line, and it's a pick-type situation, and that other guy runs underneath. Meanwhile, the Michigan trainer's looking at Evan Cooper. Cooper down injured on that play. And again, Ray, injuries cropping up, and that is not something we like to see.
Well, Cooper having a little difficulty coming off the field right now.
Cooper,
we've seen a lot of late injuries today.
Yeah, Evan Cooper hit him, and it looked like maybe Tony Gant fell on his leg or his ankle after Cooper made the hit, because it didn't look like Evan was in any kind of a situation where his ankle would have twisted by stepping on it a certain way.
Indiana, by the way, with an old friend working on that coaching staff for Sam Weiss, and that Ed O'Neill working with the linebackers his first year down there, the former Detroit Lion. First and 10 for the Hoosiers. That pro set now. Cameron wanting to throw. Hansley, did he hang on to it? No, he went down and picked it up, but it's incomplete, ruled incomplete. He's had four catches already for 33 yards, and that might have been the easiest one to him.
Yeah, Michigan again coming. They're having they're playing games up front, meaning they're looping people around, and Carlton Rose had some real good pressure, and I think Hansley just decided to run before he caught that one. Picked it up on a bounce and started downfield, and you can only do that if you're playing basketball, and I'm sure Cam Cameron could do that, but Hansley can't.
Second and 10. How about on a lateral?
Oh, maybe.
Okay. Hansley in motion. And this one coming out to Howard. And no way to go. Cohen doing a good job of covering that time.
Real nice open field tackle by Jeff Cohen. Comes out, he's got this guy wide open in the open field. Howard's a running back, and if you're a running back, you should be able to beat a defensive back. But not way Jeff Cohen did. He comes up, breaks down, gets a leg, and hangs on for dear life. And that's the way to make a tackle in the open field. If the guy doesn't go down, hold on and wait for your friends.
Third down and 9. Hansley. Shy of the first down by maybe 4 yards. I think, Jim, the Michigan defense in the second half really has reacted quickly. They really have moved around a little better than they did, especially in the second quarter.
Well, what they've done effectively, I think, is taken away the long pass, taken away the wide receivers passing down the field. Everything that Indiana has thrown has been underneath linebackers. It hasn't been the kind of offense that you can get back in a game real quickly, except for the one pass they hit, and even that one was underneath. It was a good run that got them into the end zone in this second half.
Hansley on the carry, and he is way shy of the first down. Sunchit over there to do quite a job on him. So we've got a little moment here. Let's take a break with Michigan on top, 36-18.
Here, now more than ever.
Michigan with 3:36 to go, and Michigan now with a new quarterback as Dave Hall, the senior out of Livonia Stevenson, takes over. So he'll be making his first call of the afternoon. 36-18, Wolverines leading the Hoosiers of Indiana. There goes Mercer. Mercer churning away for almost 5 yards. And another player down.
This is a little isolation play. The fullback kicks out on the linebacker, and then Mercer cuts off that block, and he saw everything opening up back inside. He made the cut back inside, and again, Ray, when you can get 5 yards, pretty much every time you come out there on first down and you're carrying the football, you just can't beat it. It's like we said last week against Wisconsin. If you can be looking at second down and 3, second and 4, you know that offensively you're doing a job on first down, and that is one of the keys for Michigan today. They've really been able to do pretty much what they wanted to do in a situation on second down. It's been their down. It hasn't been Indiana's.
Perryman and Loeb, a couple of backups, running backs for Michigan, have checked into the lineup now, so they get their first call of 1983 as Bo is going to the bench now. Perryman, a sophomore out of Massachusetts, running out of the fullback spot. And Ben Lowe, sophomore out of Atlanta, Georgia.
Perryman's from Buzzards Bay, Massachusetts. He's a very highly touted running back, fullback. He's had some injury problems early in his career, though, his freshman year.
Well, they ran him in for that play, brought him back out now. And Mercer back in there along with Armstrong. Good block by Armstrong. And Mercer carries it right around the 32-yard line of Indiana. But boy, that was a fine block on the outside by Armstrong.
Certainly was. Watch 34. Yeah, you can't see him. He's at the bottom of your screen. But he knocks down Sigler there, and that allows Mercer to turn the corner. And the only reason Mercer got around that outside corner was because Armstrong made the block and knocked down the defender who was coming up to force the play inside.
In behind Hall now, Perryman and Logue. Logue, the tailback, on a carry. And he's moving with authority across the 25-yard line. So young Mr. Logue, using 195 pounds to do the job.
Well, we're looking at the future here, and here's good running, lowering that arm and breaking tackles. He broke three tackles. One of them was on a real hard hit. So the Wolverines are showing us a little bit of what we might see in 1984 and 85.
Down to 2 minutes and 1 second remaining in this ball game, with Michigan on top 36-18. That timeout was called by Indiana, and while we were away, Weiss had his defensive unit over there and really was talking to him very strongly. Perryman on the carry, the fullback. Boy, he showed some good, quick speed, busting up the middle, down to the 10-yard line of Indiana.
Good hard running, good blocking at the point of attack. Michigan still got that first string offensive line in there, at least some guys. Now Caddis has come in at tight end, but you see Perryman really ripping through there in a big hole. Tabaccino is in there in the offensive line. Cuerna is in at the one tackle. Clay Miller is still at the strong side tackle.
Michigan has rushed for a total of 426 yards. And Perryman adds a couple of more to that one. On the carry, straight ahead, inside the 10-yard line, close to the 7-yard line.
You know, Ray, we haven't seen Perryman or Logue before this season, and I was just looking up. Ben Logue is coming out of the game right now. As a high school senior, he rushed for over 2,700 yards and 23 touchdowns and was named the Georgia Player of the Year, also a high school All-American.
No matter what competition or where you're playing at, that is superb, no matter where.
You are for sure there.
Mercer just into the lineup, trying to get to the goal line, hauled down between the two and the three. As we're under a minute now in this ball game, 54 seconds. The clock stops.
Once again, you see the offensive line burying Indiana inside. Mercer makes the cut at the line of scrimmage and gets down inside the 5-yard line to the three. That's just good blocking at the point of attack. And I think Michigan probably has beaten Indiana's spirit, if you will, Ray. Indiana got close at one point on the big touchdown by Benson here in the second half. But ever since that point, it has been Michigan. The Wolverines now are looking to get a first down inside the five, and they do, as the measurement proves them right. And the Wolverines now got four downs to get it in from the 3-yard line with 54 seconds left in this game.
No, really, Indiana in this ball game, when you look at it, till that third touchdown run by Kerry Smith in the early going of this fourth quarter. At that time, that might have been the old backbreaker. That put them up 36-18. That's where we stand right now. First and goal. 43 seconds to go. Perryman, yes sir! The youngster from Massachusetts has himself a touchdown.
And they're probably cheering in Buzzards Bay right now. That's the first touchdown of the career for Bob Perryman. And he is again a sign of the future. Big, strong fullback, but you wonder where he fits in. The Wolverines have three fullbacks, Garrett, Rice, and Armstrong, and here's another one. Bob Perryman, who's looked good here in this final drive, along with tailback Ben Logue, a couple of sophomores.
Bergeron, and a try for the extra point, with 33 seconds remaining in this ball game. Yes, it's good. And with 33 seconds to go, Michigan lead now. 43-18.
There are flags in the end zone on the extra point race. We'll have to wait and see what the officials say before we can actually count that point. The official now says that his hat is on correctly and the penalty was against Indiana. Michigan declines and the point is good. So let's mark it 43-18. Wolverines with 33 seconds left in the Michigan-Michigan State game now next week. Looks like a big one for the conference, of course.
Certainly does.
Michigan has averted what I would call a great Indiana effort here this afternoon as we take a look at the touchdown by Perryman. Good blocking of the point of attack. Perryman just rolls into the end zone from a yard out, and that was the touchdown that really I think Indiana gave Michigan because they had kind of broken their backs. Michigan now will get a real big break on the kickoff because the penalty against Indiana with too many men on the field, and it's 15 yards. That will put Schlope at Indiana's 45-yard line to kick this one off. I think the first or second row of the end zone section ought to get ready for this one.
Are in danger down there. Howard and Smith back, but I don't think they got a shot unless he gives it the old squib effort here. Well, we're very glad you could join us for our telecast for this Indiana-Michigan game. As Jim mentioned earlier, we certainly hope that you will join us for our telecast from East Lansing next week. Look out down there. Almost got the cheerleaders and everybody else.
And don't forget to join Bo Schembechler and myself for Michigan Replay. You can see on most of these Wolverine Sports Television Network stations around the state of Michigan and all over the country, actually. And we'll talk about this one. And I would imagine Bo will be somewhat disturbed with what happened through the first three quarters of this game. After having a 21-0 lead, Indiana came back and got back in it. So we will discuss that on Michigan Replay.
Of course, he always answers your questions anyway.
I like that one about the kicking game last week.
First and 10 for Indiana, 33 seconds to go in this ball game. And Cameron Hansley makes the reception at the 25-yard line. Well, our thanks today, of course, to our spotter, Brett Posant. Thank you very much. Our statistician again with us, Jim Snyder, and he's kept everything official.
Floor manager Bob Stackpool, thank you, Bob.
Second and 5. Hansley again, as time will be running out, as Hansley gets to the 45, and Michigan won its second game in a conference, knocking off the Hoosiers of Indiana. The final, Wolverines 43, the Hoosiers of Indiana 18. The Wolverines successful against the Hoosiers of Indiana 43-18 after rather a slow start in the first half today, but 440 yards on the ground.
Michigan has dominated everybody really on the ground except Washington this year. It's surprising, I think, because coming into the year, nobody was sure how good the offensive line was going to be after some losses of people like Rich Stringer and offensive guards. But I think they've done an exceptional job blocking up front. I think they'd like to see their passing game improve. More importantly, I think Bo would like to see the defense not allow teams get back in the ballgame. After opening up a 21-0 lead against Indiana today, the Wolverines let them back into a game with a big pass play in the third quarter, and it was still a game then. Against Michigan State next week, I don't think they're going to be able to run as much or as well because the Spartans have a gambling coming after your defense.
What do we expect from the Spartans offensive-wise?
I don't know. It depends a lot upon how well their backup quarterback, actually their third-string quarterback, comes through and is able to run the George Perlis offense. With the loss of Yurima and Kolb, the first two quarterbacks, there's a lot of pressure, and how much they do offensively depends upon how well that kid progresses, and it'll only be his second start.
Well, we'll find out in 1 week. Till then, the Michigan Wolverines will be satisfied with this big win over Indiana. They get all set for the Spartans. Now speaking for Jim Brandstetter, I'm Ray Lane. So long, everybody.